VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. I'm Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray. Now, there have been a few uneventful moments in the history of rock and roll. Hotel rooms that didn't get trashed, artists who stayed happily married and sober. But who cares about those? It's the shocking moments we can't forget. VH1 has compiled the ultimate list of rock's most shocking moments, and we are counting them down from 100 to number one. We start with the story of a female shock rocker who gave herself a hand in a sexy solo act, and the police were not amused.
Wendy O. Williams, the lead singer of the early 80s punk band The Plasmatics, was famous for her outrageous stage shows. Smashing TVs, guitars, and Cadillacs, she broke new ground as a female shock rocker. But one night in Milwaukee, the local police decided this former stripper's act was a little too risque.
Turn up your TV set!
By the start of 1981, the Plasmatics were flying high after a national television appearance and a hit record. But their luck was about to run out. On January 19th, 1981, while the band performed their usual set in Milwaukee, Wendy got a little friendly with a sledgehammer she used to smash things on stage. The audience cheered them on, but the police were outraged.
Apparently the police chief and so on, they'd seen this on television, so they came to the show ready to make an arrest.
Police officers waited for the show to end and then arrested the petite singer for simulating masturbation with the sledgehammer.
You have 10,000 guitar players simulating masturbation every night, and a woman happens to come along and do it, and suddenly she offends public sensibilities and gets arrested for it. So it does seem like a pretty egregious double standard.
After the show, police took Wendy outside, where things got violent.
When they took her to the paddy wagon, she felt she was groped. She turned around and belted one of the police. And at that point, they threw her to the ground, broke her nose, kicked her face in. I ran out of the club and was beaten unconscious with nightsticks, and others in our band were also arrested.
Wendy and Rod were hospitalized and then taken to jail, where they were charged with assaulting police officers. They fought the charges in court, and a jury eventually found them not guilty. The original Plasmatics broke up 6 months after the trial. And in 1998, Wendy O. Williams committed suicide. In December 1970, President Nixon declared a national war on drugs, and Elvis Presley and his friend Jerry Schilling flew to Washington, D.C. on a secret mission. Not even his wife Priscilla knew what Elvis was up to. He wanted to become an honorary drug enforcement agent, and he wanted the president to help.
He wanted a federal narcotics badge. He had been collecting badges. Now, this was the big badge.
Elvis had written this letter to Nixon saying he could help combat drug use among America's youth.
White House aides were baffled by Presley's request, but thought that he could help Nixon connect with young people. On December 21st, 1970, Presley received a call. Nixon wanted to meet him in the Oval Office. At the meeting, Elvis brought the president a gift. A chrome-plated Colt 45.
What is really amazing and a testament to Elvis's powers of persuasion is that he actually got into the Oval Office with a gun.
Presley offered to help Nixon fight the counterculture influence of the Beatles and sell the president's anti-drug message to the Woodstock generation. But he needed to have federal authority.
The president of the United States couldn't say no to Elvis.
Impressed with his sincerity, patriotism, and goodwill, Nixon declared Elvis an honorary DEA agent and awarded him the badge.
The image of Elvis Presley, heavily medicated, wearing a purple suit and a cape, and meeting with Richard Nixon, that's not just a great rock and roll history moment, that's American history.
Elvis has left the building.
A high-profile lesbian couple wanted to have a baby. She, a filmmaker. She, a Grammy Award-winning singer-songwriter. They could seemingly have their choice of any number of high-quality sperm donors. Their choice?
I know what you're thinking, baby.
When it was announced in 1996 that Melissa Etheridge's partner Julie Cypher was pregnant via artificial insemination, rumors circulated as to who the sperm donor was.
It was very carefully thought out, the whole thing. Had to be. If you want me to
keep your secret. The couple kept the donor's identity a secret following the birth of their daughter. Apparently pleased with the results, the couple had another child in 1998 using the same donor.
What we want is for our son and our daughter to know first, and then the rest of the world can know that, you know, Tom Hanks is the father. Oh.
After much pressure, Melissa and Julie finally revealed the donor's identity in Rolling Stone.
I just don't get that. To me, that is shocking. There are better donors out there. Damn near going down the street, man. You could just pick them randomly.
David Crosby has survived drug and alcohol addictions, prison terms, and a liver transplant. Perhaps Melissa and Julie chose Crosby not just for his musical ability, but for his hearty DNA.
When we come back, a concertgoer struck by lightning.
She was completely white, and there was just blood gushing out of her mouth.
And Bjork's turbulent airport arrival. Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll.
What is he?
Many musicians can be called the father of rock, but one man really earned that title. Screamin' Jay Hawkins was a world-class musical stud who was as prolific in bed as he was in the studio.
Screamin' Jay Hawkins claimed a place in rock history with an outrageous stage act and his 1956 hit, I Put a Spell on You.
I Put a Spell on You.
But his greatest legacy wasn't his music. Screamin' Jay Hawkins was married six times and had countless lovers. In the mid-50s, when Jay was performing in Atlantic City, he claimed to have made love to 14 women a night and professed his sexual prowess on the bathroom walls along the boardwalk.
Oh, let's lick it one time.
Screamin' Jay Hawkins was a very charismatic, attractive man, and he had a wonderful romantic way about him with women.
I want you to blow on me, baby.
Screamin' Jay estimated he fathered 75 children throughout his life, most of whom he had never met. But when he passed away in February of 2000, his dying wish was that all his children meet.
One of the things that he wished he had done is get to know them a little better. And he said it would be so wonderful to have them all under one roof one day, get to know who they are and what they're doing.
3 weeks after his death, a website was set up to find Hawkins' children.
I put a spell on you.
Visitors to the website were invited to submit a claim if they believed they were one of Screamin' Jay's children, or if they believed they had given birth to one of Hawkins' kids.
'Cause you're mine.
They all very much look alike. They have the same laugh.
What's up?
In the site's first year of operation, there were 2,500 submissions and 33 positive identifications.
You and I would think that's too many children to have, that's irresponsible. Screamin' Jay Hawkins was proud of every single one of the children he had.
I love you!
With her pixie looks and angelic voice, Icelandic pop star Bjork doesn't look like she could hurt a fly. Guess again. On February 19, 1996, Bjork was scheduled to do an interview with reporter Julie Kaufman when she arrived in Bangkok, Thailand. But at the last moment, Kaufman received news that the interview was off. Apparently, Bjork was in a bad mood. But nobody could have guessed just how bad it was. As Bjork exited the airport with her son, Kaufman approached the singer and said, "Welcome to Bangkok." Apparently, it was not the right thing to say. Bjork later called Kaufman to apologize for the incident, saying that she had been under a lot of stress and was upset that people had been filming her son. Kaufman refused to press charges and accepted Bjork's apology.
I just have some bruises. I have a tough head, you know. No, nothing's... I'm okay. Yeah, I'm cool.
Sometimes the people surrounding rock stars are just as eccentric as the rock stars themselves. In the next shocking moment, a group of friends went to gruesome lengths to show their loyalty to a country rock legend.
In 1973, Graham Parsons took a trip out to the desert with his road manager. Graham was riding in the back, in a coffin.
Won't a scratch my itch sweet any rich?
Graham Parsons had found fame with the Flying Burrito Brothers and the Byrds. But in September 1973, the country rock star's hard living caught up with him, and he died of a deadly combination of morphine and tequila. His adoptive father wanted a traditional burial in Louisiana. But Phil Kaufman, Parsons' road manager, decided to honor the pact he'd made with Parsons before his death.
We decided, after having several adult beverages, that if one of us should die, that we'd like to be taken out to Joshua Tree in the desert and our ashes burned out there.
Kaufman and a friend intercepted Parsons' body at a Los Angeles airport before it was claimed by his father.
A friend of mine owned a hearse, and I borrowed the hearse and went out to the airport, convinced the people there that the family wanted the body flown out of a private airport, and that my partner and I were there to take the body. And we were pretty convincingly as drunk as we were.
And the body was released to the two men.
We drove out to the desert, opened the casket and saw Graham, and then I poured the gas on him, and I lit a match, threw it in there. And this dust devil went up, and his ashes went up into the air like that, into the desert night, with millions of stars, and just as he would want it.
Kaufman was later arrested, but since there is no law in California against stealing a body, he was charged with grand theft for the coffin and fined $300.
They charged me with stealing the casket because the body had no intrinsic value. So I just got done for stealing the wrapper. If I'd known that, I would have, you know, left the box and just taken the body. But in retrospect, it's too late now.
The doctor said the lightning was a direct hit, which meant that it went, you know, from the sky right to me.
It was June 1998. The first day of the Tibetan Freedom Benefit Concert at RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C. The sun was out and the crowd was in high spirits. But at 3 p.m., Herbie Hancock took the stage and the skies began to darken.
It started getting really dark and all of a sudden it was black and mysterious and you knew something was going to happen.
There was an instantaneous blue flash, blue-white flash, and an explosion.
No one knew what hit.
It was kind of like, what is that? Was it a bomb? Was it a special effect that went wrong? And then the second one happened and knocked us both out.
When Amanda came to, she found her sister lying unconscious. Lisa's cell phone had been struck by lightning.
She was completely white and there was just blood gushing out of her mouth. And she had burn holes all the way down her right side.
She wasn't breathing. She was in a full cardiac arrest.
Two concert goers rushed to Lisa's aid.
They did CPR and compressions, and it took 7 minutes before they got a pulse. And then in the interim, RFK's emergency team got to me, and they put me into the ambulance. I still have no memory of this.
The wind and the rain increased, and the concert was halted.
You know, we were in touch with the National Weather Service, and it looked like a 25% chance that more lightning would be coming, and it was not safe.
Fans left the stadium without seeing half the bands on the roster. R.E.M., Radiohead, and the Red Hot Chili Peppers were rescheduled to play the next day.
I don't ever want to feel like I did that.
If you're going to get struck by lightning, you have to get struck at a concert. Anthony Kiedis came to the hospital to visit me, and he brought me this very cool card that a bunch of the band signed, and it was like hanging out with an old friend.
Lisa suffered second and third degree burns over 20% of her body and a punctured eardrum.
I think what it was, you know, it was just bad luck. Wrong place, wrong time.
Even though I was calling people saying, she doesn't look well, I still didn't think she'd actually pass away.
In 1970, the Carpenters burst onto the pop music scene, captivating audiences worldwide.
Why do birds suddenly...
The Carpenters didn't just hit, they exploded.
Karen Carpenter's haunting vocals, a blend of innocence and sorrow, made her famous, but her success came with a price.
We spend an awful lot of time trying to achieve perfection as close as we can come. It's the foremost thing in both of our minds at all times.
In her quest for a perfect life, she became obsessed with her appearance, taking extreme measures to control her weight.
She had very low self-esteem. It started from an interview that she did, and somebody called her chubby, and she flipped.
She'd get her dinner, but she'd put the food under the plate so she didn't have to eat it, and that's when she got thinner and thinner.
By 1981, Karen's weight had dropped to 77 pounds. Fearing for her life, she checked herself into a hospital where she was diagnosed with anorexia nervosa.
The only way any weight was put on her really was from being put into a hospital and then having it pumped in.
She gained 10 pounds during 1 week. You don't gain 10 pounds in 1 week. It's not good for your heart.
Karen was optimistic that she was winning her battle with anorexia. But after years of starvation, the sudden weight gain had taken a toll on her heart. On February 4th, 1983, Karen suffered a fatal heart attack. She was 32 years old.
Coming up, Stevie Wonder's near-fatal crash.
Where I felt I was spiritually was a much higher place.
And a homeless hoaxer becomes a star for a day.
Why couldn't you impersonate like the Lone Ranger or Tano or something like that?
When the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll continues. Cover bands are the sincerest form of flattery. But in this next shocking moment, one fan took his tribute to Kiss drummer Peter Criss a little too far.
In the 1970s, he made millions as the drummer for Kiss. But in 1991, tabloids reported he was a homeless alcoholic, panhandling for nickels under the Santa Monica Pier. Only, it wasn't him. By 1991, Peter Criss had disappeared from the public eye until the January edition of Star magazine hit the newsstands. The article claimed that a down-on-his-luck Criss was drunk, broke, and homeless. Lifelong Kiss fan Tom Arnold saw the article and went down to the Santa Monica Pier to try and help the troubled drummer.
I saw a guy with about 10 other homeless guys around him. He's like an entourage, you know, like Elvis, you know, and I figured that's got to be him.
But it wasn't. It was Christopher Dickinson, a homeless man who had passed himself off as Peter Criss for years and was paid $500 to cooperate with the story.
And then Peter Criss was like, you know, wait a minute, you know? Dude, that's not me.
The real Peter Criss was quietly raising a family in Redondo Beach, California. A month after the article was published, Peter Criss appeared on The Donahue Show to expose the fraud, clear his name, and confront his imposter.
How you doing?
Better.
Why couldn't you impersonate like the Lone Ranger or Tano or something like that?
The two Peters made their peace on the show. The real Peter Criss went on to sue the star for libel. They eventually settled out of court. Stevie Wonder was a superstar by the age of 23, but on August 6, 1973, the world held its breath as he fought for his life. Stevie was sleeping in the front seat of a car on the way to a benefit in North Carolina when his driver slammed into a logging truck. The impact knocked a log off the truck. The log smashed through the windshield and into Stevie's head. He was rushed to the hospital with massive head injuries and lapsed into a coma. Doctors weren't sure he would survive and predicted if he did come out of the coma, he could have permanent brain damage.
People were shocked. I mean, this person who'd overcome so much adversity, this disaster happening to him when he was still such a young, rising, fresh, huge talent.
Friends and family spent days at his bedside while Stevie struggled for his life. After 4 days, Stevie emerged from the coma.
some of the time I was not aware of where I was, but where I felt I was spiritually was a much higher place and made me aware of a lot of things that I have to do and that were happening that had to change and will give me a lot of the things to write about.
Within 2 months of the crash, Wonder returned to recording, and in the years following the accident, he released the most critically acclaimed and commercially successful music of his career.
He had to use that huge machine of his imagination even more intensely, and he still came up with the most amazing, beautiful music.
If you have hit records, you make a lot of money, right? You'd think so, but one mighty rapper was shocked to learn he was not too legit for Chapter 11.
He escaped his ghetto roots, earned an estimated $50 million, and was too legit to quit. Until he realized he was broke. In 1990, rap hit the big time.
Have a time!
And three-time Grammy winner MC Hammer brought it to the masses. He had record sales in the millions, sold out shows around the world, and was even made into a toy doll.
Break it down.
Hammer was extremely generous with his newfound fame and fortune. He donated money to inner city programs and employed his friends from the old neighborhood. He also treated himself to the finer things in life. He bought cars and racehorses and spent over $10 million to build his dream house, a 12.5-acre mansion with two swimming pools and a 9-car garage.
I remember going to Hammer and saying, yo, there are rumors, man, that you're throwing some mad, mad dollars around, man. And he's all the crazy rumors.
But by 1992, gangster rappers were topping the charts. And Hammer's record sales slumped. Suddenly, there wasn't enough money to go around.
To put it in perspective, let's say that Hammer made $30 million. Let's give the government 40% right away. So now we're talking about $14 million. You talk about a $10 million house after taxes, then that means you got $4 million left.
In 1996, Hammer was forced to declare bankruptcy.
$10 million was a little too extravagant for your dream house, even if it's your dream house. And I had to learn that one the hard way.
I gave Hammer a stage to perform, but I probably should have also given him my accountant's number.
He was the drummer in one of the 80s biggest bands when a near-fatal car crash threatened to end his career forever. By 1984, Def Leppard was flying high with their multi-platinum metal album, Pyromania. On New Year's Eve of that year, drummer Rick Allen was driving on a rural English road with his girlfriend when out of nowhere,
this red Alfa Romeo came screaming around the corner. And every time I tried to pass him, this guy would speed up again. I lost my temper to the point where I don't even remember going around the corner.
Allen tried again to pass the car. But his Corvette crashed over a stone wall. As the car rolled into a field, Rick's arm was severed from his body.
I think the first thing I remember was standing up in this field and just saying, you know, well, I've lost my arm and I'm a drummer.
New Year's Eve, around about 2 or 3 in the afternoon, I got a call from Peter Mensch, our manager, explaining what had happened.
He said, Rick's had a car crash, he's lost his arm.
Allen was rushed to the hospital, where he underwent a 4-hour emergency surgery to reattach his arm. But several days later, the reattached arm became severely infected and had to be amputated.
It's almost like giving you something back and then taking it away for the second time. It seemed very, very cruel.
Determined not to lose his day job, Allen taught himself to drum with one arm while he was still in the hospital. Just 6 weeks after the accident, Allen rejoined Def Leppard.
I was just hell-bent on getting back in there and, you know, and making the band happy.
And proved that he could rock just as hard with one arm. He was a peace-preaching pop star who quit making music to follow his soul. But when he re-emerged a decade later, no one could believe what he had to say. When Salman Rushdie's Satanic Verses was published in 1989, the writer was condemned to death by the Ayatollah Khomeini, who claimed the book criticized the Muslim religion. Most of the artistic community supported Rushdie, but former pop star Cat Stevens, who had converted to the Islamic religion, denounced the author.
As far as the Muslim community is concerned, it's as good as stabbing Muslims in the heart.
Though he didn't literally condone the death threat, he didn't mince words in his criticism of Rushdie.
Any writer who abuses any prophet under Islamic law, the sentence for that is actually death.
His comments made news worldwide.
The singer Cat Stevens, a convert to Islam, has said that the Quran makes it clear that Salman Rushdie should die.
Radio stations stopped playing his albums and staged record demolitions.
Certainly at the time it was perceived as Cat Stevens throwing his support behind this threat of assassination. That was kind of shocking for any rock star.
At the time, Stevens claimed his words were taken out of context and he never actually supported Rushdie's death.
I didn't come out, you know, on day one and say, kill Rushdie. I mean, I never even knew that there was such a judgment on this particular matter.
And in 2000, he went even further to explain that at the time he was new in the faith and naive about how his comments would be interpreted.
Well, if you want to sing out, and if you want to be free, be free.
Cat Stevens wasn't the only artist to shock us by finding religion. In 1989, Madonna showed us her spiritual side, and it wasn't exactly what the church had in mind.
Madonna faced one of her career's biggest controversies when she tried to join the Pepsi generation. In 1989, Madonna signed a multi-million dollar contract with Pepsi, who agreed to debut her new single, Like a Prayer, on a Pepsi commercial. One day after the commercial premiered, Madonna released a video for the song.
It's one of the heaviest videos she's ever done in terms of the subject matter she's playing with.
With the burning crosses and the bleeding palms and the black Jesus-like figure, the video itself was enough to shock a lot of people.
I close my eyes.
It dealt with a lot of taboos and it made people afraid.
The video was denounced by religious groups as blasphemous.
She took on a subject that people at the very least think should be respected, even if they don't believe in it. That's where she got herself in trouble, and she got herself in trouble with her sponsors as well.
Madonna's corporate marriage to Pepsi is proving as stormy as her real-life marriage to Sean Penn.
I knew right away that people were not going to be able to separate the commercial and the song from the video in the song.
Christian groups threatened to boycott Pepsi and put pressure on the company to stop running the ads. Pepsi ran the commercial only twice and officially pulled it off the air a month after its debut.
Pepsi acted in the best interest of their business and pulled the plug.
But the uproar didn't quiet Madonna.
And I'd like to thank Pepsi for causing so much controversy.
Like a Prayer spent 3 weeks at number one, and Madonna got to keep close to $5 million from the Pepsi deal. The Ghetto Boys made their name in the rap game with their outlandish inner-city narratives, but it was pint-sized rapper Bushwick Bill's brush with death and talk of a lawsuit that brought them their biggest headlines.
Aw, man, homie. My mind is playing tricks on me.
Richard Shaw stood 3 feet 8 inches tall, but as Ghetto Boys rapper Bushwick Bill, his outlandish personality was larger than life and a big part of the Ghetto Boys' success.
I was born in a rundown hospital.
But for Bushwick Bill, success meant more money, more problems.
I got friends and women on my tip, but when they look at Richard, all they see is Bushwick.
One night, overwhelmed by his life, Bushwick Bill hit the bottle hard, drinking 190 proof grain alcohol.
I broke out the Everclear and then I drunk some more.
Bill was drunk, depressed, and suicidal, but for religious reasons, he couldn't kill himself, so he begged his girlfriend to shoot him. She refused, and they fought violently over a handgun Bill was brandishing. And then it went off.
Oh, man. I'm hit. My eye.
Shot in the eye, Bill was rushed to the hospital, where the Geto Boys snapped this photo for the cover of their next album, and later made a video documenting the episode.
And I'm glad that I'm here, G, but it's messed up. I had to lose an eye to see things clearly.
It was reported that Bill planned to sue the liquor company that made the grain alcohol, claiming it contributed to the shooting, but he changed his mind. And his name.
My new name is Dr. Wolfgang von Buschwagen the Barbarian, motherfunky, stay high dollar bill stir.
When we return, Whitney Houston backs out of the Oscars.
It's not right.
Marilyn Manson makes a deal with the devil. Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. When Whitney Houston backed out of the Oscars at the last minute, rumors flew. Was it stage fright, substance abuse, or just another case of ADD? Acute diva disorder.
And I will always love you.
When she backed out of the Oscars at the last minute, it was rumored that this high-profile diva was dabbling in drugs.
Heartbreak Hotel. This is a...
Whitney Houston was scheduled to perform at the 2000 Academy Awards, but 48 hours before showtime, something went awry. Word leaked out that the star had behaved erratically during rehearsals, appearing confused and disheveled, and missing musical cues from bandleader Burt Bacharach.
These kinds of huge productions are planned months and months and months in advance, and for an artist either to be asked to leave or not to show up is a very rare occurrence that close to the actual performance.
It's not right.
The incident was simply the latest in a long string of canceled concerts and no-show appearances. In August 1999, Whitney backed out of a California concert just minutes before showtime, complaining of a sore throat, and cost promoters over $100,000. And just 3 weeks before the Oscars, she failed to appear at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction of her mentor and former Arista head, Clive Davis. Whitney's erratic behavior fanned the flame of drug rumors that had plagued her for much of the year. In January, half an ounce of marijuana had been found in her luggage in a Hawaii airport, and Houston fled before authorities could arrest her. Whitney denied there was a problem.
It's incredible that the press has a right to write freely, but there are no amendments for our privacy.
The Oscar show went on with Faith Hill replacing Houston.
Well, I just got a phone call yesterday morning to come be a part of the show, and I'm here.
And on April 10th, 2000, Whitney made headlines again when she appeared, as scheduled, at an Arista Records tribute to Clive Davis. In the late 60s, John Lennon asked the world to give peace a chance. But by the early 70s, his anti-war views made him a target of the U.S. government.
Here in some stranger's room.
When John and his wife Yoko Ono arrived in New York City in 1971, they became vocal opponents of the Nixon administration and U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War. In 1972, when South Carolina Senator Strom Thurmond learned that Lennon planned to perform at an anti-Nixon rally outside the GOP convention, he sent a memo to Attorney General John Mitchell and suggested Lennon be deported. The Attorney General sent Thurmond's memo to the INS, who revoked Lennon's visa and ordered him to leave the country. The INS denied they were trying to deport Lennon because of his anti-war views and cited a 1968 drug conviction for his expulsion.
His problem seems to be the marijuana conviction. This is the kind of treatment we would dish out to anybody convicted of a narcotics offense.
But Lennon believed the deportation order was politically motivated and started a campaign to stay in the country.
A few friends of ours in the pop business have exactly the same conviction as me and are allowed to come and go as free as they like. They just don't happen to have the same point of view as me.
The FBI began investigating Lennon, placing him under constant surveillance.
When it first started, I was followed in the car, and my phone was tapped.
In 1983, FBI documents revealed a politically motivated attempt to deport Lennon. In 1975, after 3 years of legal maneuvering, a judge overturned the deportation order, granting Lennon permanent residence in the U.S. Before Before he became the world-famous shock rocker, Marilyn Manson took a little detour into religion. In 1994, the virtually unknown Marilyn Manson was on tour as the opening act for Nine Inch Nails. According to Manson's autobiography, on one stop in San Francisco, he was invited to the home of Anton LaVey, the world-famous Satanist, for a private meeting.
He was sincerely interested in the ideas that the Church of Satan promoted, not because he wanted to, you know, worship a red guy with horns, but because he was interested in the idea of a church devoted to the exact opposite of Christianity.
Manson arrived at the LaVey homestead alone at 2 a.m. as requested. He was brought into the house by a spooky assistant and led to a meeting room where he claims LaVey simply appeared. The two spoke at great lengths about such stars as Jane Mansfield and Sammy Davis Jr., who LaVey claimed were followers of his. Anton LaVey was so impressed with Manson that he officially certified him as a minister in the Church of Satan.
The whole idea of a Church of Satan has always seemed a little bit silly to me. There's supposedly this great, powerful Dark Lord Satan. Why is he going to be hanging out with like four or five goth kids in a basement?
You know, doing the Satan thing is like so 1975 at this point. It shouldn't even seem scary.
Since entering the satanic priesthood, Manson has sold over 3 million records around the world.
When we return, Boy George bottoms out.
Heroin puts you in a bubble, and you're cut off from the world and what you feel.
And an explosive performance from The Who. Next, on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. Came into the picture, this boy almost didn't live to tell the story.
Do you really want to hurt me?
Heroin puts you in a bubble. You know, it just kind of slows everything down. You get this kind of glaze over your eyes, and you're cut off from the world and what you feel.
In the early 80s, Culture Club achieved worldwide success with a string of top 10 hits and colorful videos. But the fame and success soon slipped away.
I was an extreme person in every respect of the word. Drugs, fashion.
By 1986, George had developed a crippling addiction to heroin. And at this June anti-apartheid benefit, there was no denying his problem.
It was really disturbing, to be honest. He was totally out of it, you know, it was when he was going through his drugs phase.
Without even talking, taking money off him or anything.
I remember him signing an autograph for somebody, and he was just literally, he was nodding off to sleep, and then he got pen on the end of his nose. And it was so, so sad. And after that, there was all the roar in the press, Junkie George has 8 weeks to live.
Fearing for George's life, his brother went public.
Is your brother addicted to heroin?
Well, you've only got to look at him. I mean, he looks gaunt. The sparkle that used to be in his eye is gone. At the time when my brother went on TV, I was really angry and I wanted to throttle him. And then I wasn't really compos mentis at the time, you know, I wasn't really thinking straight.
As his family reached out, George's life continued to spiral out of control.
For me, you know, I've got a really strong family and people really kind of rallied around and were very protective.
Boy George eventually beat his addiction to heroin and continues to perform around the world. Riding the wave of the British invasion, The Who set out to shake up America, but no one knew just how far they'd go. On September 15th, 1967, The Who were set to perform on the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour.
The Smothers Brothers had a fairly radical show at the time, and they bravely asked us if we'd destroy our instruments.
The Who were already known for their guitar-smashing antics, but for this performance, they wanted something with a little more bang.
Keith persuaded the pyrotechnician on the show to make a cannon, which he put inside his drum.
So I did that.
And in the rehearsal, it went bang, but it kind of made a lot of smoke and made a bit of a dull thud. And Keith said, listen, you know, you must increase the charge.
So we increased the firepower for the explosion. And unknown to anybody else,
Keith goes in and sneaks in. He loads a load in.
So now you've got maybe three times the original.
So they had a triple load in this cannon.
And then The Who took the stage.
You gotta sing My Generation. This song really goes, and you're gonna be surprised what happens, because this is excitement. And hit it.
As they finished the song, the destruction began.
They're banging this stuff, a cup of smoke is happening.
And I gave the cue to set off the explosion.
I was standing right in front of it, and it blew the front of the drum off. And it set my hair on light.
Pete Townsend comes out of the smoke, and I know his head's ringing. I'm looking around to see where the injured are lying.
But Pete Townsend wasn't done yet.
He grabs a guitar from me, he stands, he takes it off my thing, he takes it, and he gives it a shot, and smashes it. And that probably was the most earth-shattering of all of the things.
Keith Moon and Pete Townsend suffered minor shrapnel wounds, and the explosion was later blamed for Townsend's hearing loss.
Well, that wraps up the first hour of VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. Whether you're recovering from the shock or you're not shocked enough, hold on. There are still 80 more of rock's shocking moments to come. I'm Mark McGrath, and I'll see you then.
It was the most humiliating ordeal of my life.
Mr. Sockman today.
Fat to me doesn't necessarily mean gay people.
If someone's waving their genitalia at you, you don't automatically assume that they're an officer of the law.
Gary Glitter has been charged with child pornography.
Fire in the house now. I'm only 13 years old.
Michael Hutchence was found hanging.
Who brought a chicken to the concert?
It was covered in blood.
I have two warrants for Jim Morrison.
I was followed in the car, and my phone was tapped.
Cobain was killed by a shotgun blast.
I'm going home.
Die, 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 pig, die. Catchy little number, isn't it?
There were bodies laying everywhere.
Had nothing to do with a shooting.
Come on!
This is VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. I'm Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray. Now, the rock and roll lifestyle has its perks and hazards. The perks are the attention, the fame, and the money. And the hazards are the attention, the fame, and the money. Which could explain why rock has given us so many shocking moments. VH1 has come up with a list of rock's 100 most shocking moments, and we have 80 to go. Now, have you ever wondered what would happen if you tried to videotape a rock concert? As one fan found out, it can have riotous consequences, especially when Axl Rose is involved.
In 1987, Guns N' Roses topped the charts with Appetite for Destruction. But one night in 1991, that appetite got out of hand.
Welcome to the jungle. We got fun and games.
On July 2nd, the band was playing to a packed stadium in St. Louis, Missouri, when Axl Rose noticed a fan with a camera just below the stage and tried to stop him from taping the show.
Hey, take that! Take that! Now, get that guy and take that!
When security didn't act fast enough, Axel took matters into his own hands.
I'll take it, Eric.
Axel just lost it, you know. This fan was yelling at him and he jumped on him.
Thanks to the lame-ass security, I'm going home.
Axel stormed off the stage and the band followed.
The audience just went nuts. I mean, here's the guy who's supposed to be organizing their anger, their energy. He's out of there. So, of course, they all went nuts, too.
The crowd rushed the stage and began rioting. By the end of the night, over 60 fans and 20 cops were injured. Axl Rose was charged with 4 counts of assault, put on probation, and ordered to donate $50,000 to charity. The fan with the camera sued Axl for damages, but settled for a minimal sum and an autograph. What 1970s concert spectacle involved a rock band, a 45-piece orchestra, a full choir, and medieval sword-fighting knights? It was the myths and legends of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. And former Yes keyboard player Rick Wakeman staged it on ice in 1975. Rick Wakeman was the king of the rock keyboards during the 1970s. After a stint with Yes, Wakeman went solo as a caped crusader with a taste for the larger than life. His keyboard opus, The Myths and Legends of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table, was a mix of Arthurian legend, Moog synthesizers, and progressive rock bombast. Wakeman thought it only fitting that his concept album received the staging it deserved.
What I wanted to do was to try and find some way of presenting the concert without using a futuristic idea and using something to complement the orchestra and complement us and the piece of music. So we decided to do it as an ice ballet.
One of the most expensive and ambitious concerts of its time, King Arthur typified the era's bigger is better mentality.
You look back and go, wow, you know, that was kind of showmanship. But on the other hand, it was totally ridiculous.
I remember my dad saying, do you know that he mounted this on ice? And I was like, wow, that's cool. I was wrong, Dad. It's not cool. It's really self-indulgent and boring.
Thank you very much.
Despite selling out Wembley Arena, Wakeman lost his cape on the proceedings, and the show closed after only 3 performances. When Kiss arrived on the scene in the early 70s, they took shock rock to another level. But one night, the blood spewing and fire breathing went a little too far. On New Year's Eve 1973, Kiss played their biggest show to date, opening for Blue Oyster Cult in New York City. They took the stage and shocked the audience with space-age costumes, metallic platforms, and outlandish makeup.
Kiss was cool because they could wear makeup and not look wimpy. That makeup was snarly. That looked cool.
Kiss were like this great combination of heavy metal, Alice Cooper, and Kabuki theater. It was a total spectacle, and it was unlike anything really that had been seen before.
But the spectacle almost got out of control when Simmons poured kerosene into his mouth and accidentally lit himself on fire.
We were doing this fire breathing routine, and I caught my hair on fire, and, you know, the roadies came out from the sides and put me out, and people thought, wow, that's great. This guy sets himself on fire, and do it again.
Shocked but unharmed, Simmons finished the show, and the Kiss phenomenon was born.
It was a very, very exciting and scary time.
But have you seen these guys without makeup? Now that's shocking. But we all love Kiss. When we come back, rock legends immortalize their biggest assets.
What better way to immortalize your undying loyalty to one of your rock gods than to get him to plunge his penis into a bucket of dental plaster?
And Carney Wilson gets rid of hers.
My boobs were up to my chin. I could barely speak. It was pulled up so frickin' tight. You know, and that sucked.
Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll.
Hold on for one more day.
Rock's Rockstar worship took a new twist in the late 60s when one groupie elevated her devotion to the male anatomy to a high art.
She was a legendary groupie who pioneered a members-only club that made quite an impression in the art world. I'm gonna give you my love. In 1966, Cynthia Alberton, an avid rock fan, had the innovative idea to make plaster casts of Rockstar's most intimate instruments.
In art class, the teacher said you could plaster cast almost anything that's solid, I thought.
After practicing on School Friends, Cynthia got her first big break when Jimi Hendrix came to town and agreed to be cast.
Jimmy was a very cooperative subject.
What better way to immortalize your undying loyalty to one of your rock gods than to get him to plunge his penis into a bucket of dental plaster? Where you going with that
gun in your hand? But Cynthia was still perfecting her technique.
I didn't know enough to lubricate a certain part of the body, and so a few hairs got stuck in the mold. So I had to pull out each one by one, so I wouldn't hurt them. They didn't mind.
Removing the mold almost turned to disaster when Cynthia cracked the cast, but she glued Jimmy back together, and his cast proved to be the biggest in her collection.
It was known as the Penis de Milo.
Those plaster casters were smart, because if you ever wondered if you wanted to, you know, have sex with a guy, this is a really good way to preview things.
Cynthia is still casting rock stars, and her collection of almost 50 phalluses has been displayed in art galleries nationwide.
One of the most shocking movies of all time. You know, on paper, that looked like such a good idea. And so many careers went down the tubes after that.
In 1978, the Bee Gees were riding high with their multi-platinum soundtrack to Saturday Night Fever. Their producer and manager, Robert Stigwood, was eager to cash in on the group's popularity and the success of his immensely popular films, Grease and Saturday Night Fever. His plan? To make a big-budget musical loosely based on the Beatles album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, with a little help from his friends.
Somebody had the idea, let's use the greatest rock album of all time as a huge marketing tool for the Bee Gees and Peter Frampton. And that's where the bubble burst.
My original feeling about doing anything to do with the Beatles is don't.
But in the end, Peter Frampton and the Bee Gees headlined the all-star cast, which included Aerosmith, Billy Preston, and Alice Cooper.
Everybody went, oh, this is gonna be huge. Nobody realized what a stinker it was. And as soon as they were in the middle of it, everybody says, you know what, this is absolutely blasphemous to the Beatles.
There are a lot of movies and records that were made in the 70s that just seem like the product of excessive cocaine use.
Little attention was given to the script or the fact that the rock stars had limited acting experience.
When everybody realized it wasn't gonna work, was when George Burns had to come in and do all the dialogue because nobody could handle lines.
Oh, well.
On July 21st, 1978, Sgt. Pepper's opened in theaters around the country. Ticket sales were dismal, and the reviews were even worse.
That was a bad movie. And it really sunk the Stigwood organization in a lot of ways.
The commercial and critical bomb marked the beginning of the end for Frampton, the Bee Gees, and Robert Stigwood.
It was the best of times, it was the worst of times.
It was the worst. It was the best of times, but it was the worst of films.
In 1999, singer Carney Wilson faced life-threatening consequences if she didn't lose weight. So she underwent a controversial surgical procedure to reduce the size of her stomach and broadcast it live on the internet. The daughter of Beach Boy Brian Wilson, Carney Wilson found a spotlight of her own with the early 90s pop trio Wilson Phillips. Don't you know, things will change, things will go your way, your hold on. But the limelight only made Carney's lifelong battle of the bulge more difficult, and by 1999, her weight had ballooned to 300 pounds.
I had to wear like corsets and pull in my fat, and my boobs were up to my chin. I could barely speak. It was pulled up so frickin' tight, you know, and that sucked.
Carney was deemed morbidly obese by her doctors, so she opted to have her stomach stapled or reduced in size. And she decided to broadcast it live on the internet.
They're now making a hole through the lesser omentum and into the space behind the stomach.
So Carney Wilson had a live webcast of her stomach being stapled. It's a sad and beautiful time to be alive, I think.
Carney said she broadcast her surgery in order to let people know that morbid obesity is a clinical disease and bypass surgery can help. More than 100,000 people logged onto the webcast.
This is a view of Carney Wilson's intestines. This is a view of Carney Wilson's intestines.
Since the August 1999 surgery, Carney's lost over 150 pounds, gotten married, and reformed Wilson Phillips.
Carney Wilson's intestines.
Goodbye.
Trying out a new sound is always an artistic risk for a musician. But as Neil Young found out, sometimes it can also be a legal risk.
Neil Young made a career out of being independent. But in 1985, after three experimental albums, his record label had had enough. Throughout the 1960s and 70s, Neil Young struck gold with melodic folk and rock anthems. But in 1982, Young signed with David Geffen's record label and began experimenting with brand new sounds. His first release for Geffen was the experimental techno-rock album, Trance. Then he recorded a country album called Old Ways. Geffen originally refused to release the album and ordered Young to make a rock and roll record. In response, Young recorded an old-fashioned rockabilly album titled Everybody's Rockin'. The authentic 50s rock and roll sound wasn't exactly what Geffen executives had in mind.
I've been walking all night long. My footsteps made me crazy.
Basically, he was making some experimental, some different sorts of records, and they were saying, Neil Young, you're not sounding enough like Neil Young.
In 1985, Geffen slapped Neil Young with a $3 million lawsuit for making unrepresentative, non-commercial music.
Artists who want to stay vital always want to do new things. Record companies always want artists to remake what was successful before, and that was the battle between Neil Young and Geffen Records. Why don't you make Harvest again?
The suit was eventually settled out of court. And in 1988, Young left Geffen Records and ironically soon returned to his more traditional sound.
Neil Young never stopped making the records that he wants to make, and that's the victory.
In 1985, John Fogerty released his first album in over 10 years. But while it raced up the charts, Fogerty found himself in the middle of a bizarre lawsuit.
He take a thunder from the mountain. He take a lightning from the sky.
In the late 60s and early 70s, Fogerty wrote dozens of hits with Creedence Clearwater Revival for Saul Zance's Fantasy Records. But in 1985, when Fogerty released his new single, The Old Man Down the Road, Zance claimed it sounded too much like CCR's Run Through the Jungle and sued Fogerty for plagiarizing himself.
The ways and notions of record companies can be strange things indeed. And so you got John Fogerty being sued for sounding too much like John Fogerty.
During the two-week trial, Fogerty took the stand with his guitar and played both songs back-to-back to show the differences between them.
I know to stand up to somebody and say, you can't make me do that because that's stupid.
Though there was a distinct similarity between the songs, it took the jury less than 3 hours to conclude that John Fogerty was not guilty of self-plagiarism.
You know, I don't think you get punished for having sort of a signature sound. I mean, that's what it is to be a memorable artist.
After the break, the King of Queen fights his biggest battle.
There just came a day when he said, look, I have this thing and I only have a certain amount of time left. I don't want anyone to know. I don't want anyone to talk about it from this point forward.
And the Chili Peppers let it all hang out.
And there's always the element of danger because, you know, someone could reach up and grab the sock off. Oh, yeah!
When VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll continues. Well, it's just another Friday night. A nightclub, some girls, some friends, and some guns. But that mix spelled trouble for one rap mogul.
By 1999, it seemed that Sean Puffy Combs had crossed over from gangster rapper to mainstream entertainment mogul. Yeah, what y'all wanna do? Wanna be ballers? But the year ended with a bang, literally. On December 27th, 1999, Puffy went out for a night on the town.
When he went out to Club New York that night, he was just going to have a good time. He brought his girlfriend with him.
But what happened that night was anything but a good time. Inside the club, there was an argument. Shots rang out, and three people were injured. In the confusion, Puff Daddy fled the scene, and minutes later was stopped by police, arrested, and forced to spend the night in jail. Prosecutors alleged that Combs and Jamal Shine Barrow pulled out guns inside the crowded club when another man tossed money at them. Then Shine opened fire while Combs and Jennifer Lopez fled in his Navigator. The driver claimed Puffy tried to bribe him with a diamond pinky ring and said Puffy wanted him to claim ownership of the guns. After posting bail, Puff Daddy told a different story.
I want to make this 100% clear. I had nothing to do with a shooting in this club. And I feel terrible that people were hurt that night. All you suckers, liars, court testifiers.
On March 16th, 2001, after a 7-week trial, Shine was found guilty of first and second degree assault. Sean Puffy Combs was found innocent of all charges.
There just came a day when he said, look, I have this thing and I only have a certain amount of time left. I don't want anyone to know. I don't want anyone to talk about it from this point forward.
Freddie Mercury, the charismatic lead singer of Queen, led the band to the peak of rock and roll success. But when he contracted the AIDS virus in the mid-80s, he became the first of many in the rock world to deal with the disease in public.
At the time that he was sick, there wasn't a lot of dialogue about AIDS in the public.
Mercury only shared the truth about his disease with his closest friends.
We didn't tell a soul, we didn't tell our families.
He didn't want to be an object of pity or anything like that. So we just closed ranks and worked as hard as we could.
Queen retreated to the studio and tried to conduct business as usual. But Freddie's appearance led the British tabloids to speculate on his health.
The newspapers in England were so brutal and vile. And I just think, you know, it's a bit like coming out of the closet. It's like everybody has their time, and you have to do it when you feel safe.
On November 23rd, 1991, Freddie Mercury announced to the world that he had AIDS. He died the next day of pneumonia and became rock's first major AIDS casualty. In April 1992, 72,000 fans and a roster of stars, including Annie Lennox, David Bowie, and George Michael, paid tribute to Freddie Mercury at a Wembley Arena memorial concert.
Him dying from it, I think that brought a lot of awareness into the rock and roll world about AIDS.
The proceeds from the concert were donated to AIDS charities around the world. When this funk metal band burst on the California scene in the mid-80s, they showed the world a whole new way to wear socks. From their earliest days, the Red Hot Chili Peppers were notorious for their risque stage shows. But their most daring performance was during a show at a Hollywood strip club in 1984.
Nudity was kind of, you know, par for the course. We were like, let's do Sock Man tonight. We thought it was funny.
We were backstage and we were all nervous and excited and should we do this? Yeah, let's just do it.
When the band returned to the stage for an encore, concertgoers got a little more than they bargained for.
They come back and they've got the socks on. You know where the socks go. I thought it was hysterical.
The entire band was stark naked, except for strategically placed socks, and the crowd went wild.
It was a gas. It felt great to be on stage naked, you know, with this sort of exaggerated phallus, you know, dangling between our legs. There's always the element of danger because, you know, someone can reach up and grab the sock off.
Sock Man remained a part of the Peppers' repertoire for years, but they eventually decided to pack the socks away.
People ended up thinking that it was a gimmick or that, you know, the music was secondary, but they had it backwards. You know, we were about writing songs and creating this energy through music. Performing with these socks on just felt good.
23 years after members of the Southern rock band Lynyrd Skynyrd died in a plane crash, an avid group of fans went to extreme lengths to dig up the facts.
It was the urban myth someone would stop at nothing to uncover. More than 20 years after a plane crash killed three members of Lynyrd Skynyrd, their graves were mysteriously ransacked on June 29th, 2000. The bag containing the ashes of guitarist Steve Gaines was torn open, and some of his remains had spilled onto the grass. Lead singer Ronnie Van Zant's casket had been pulled from the mausoleum and dumped on the ground. While the vandals are still at large, the motive is rumored to be rooted in the band's ongoing feud with Neil Young.
Neil Young wrote a song called Southern Man, denouncing Southern racism. When Lynyrd Skynyrd heard that, they took Neil out in their song Sweet Home Alabama. Well, I hope Neil Young.
According to legend, Van Zant took the feud to his grave and was buried in a Neil Young t-shirt. The vandals were apparently trying to confirm it.
I've heard of, you know, memorabilia fetishism, but that's ridiculous. I mean, how could they tell it was a Neil Young t-shirt at this point anyway?
I highly doubt he was buried in a Neil Young t-shirt. Southern boys who have Southern moms, I seriously doubt she let her son be buried in a t-shirt.
And according to Van Zant's wife, he wasn't. Judy Van Zant said she buried her husband in a flannel shirt and jeans. The graves of Van Zant and Gaines have since been moved to an undisclosed location, and a $28,000 reward has been offered for information on the vandals. He was the teen idol turned finger-popping hipster who made Mac the Knife his personal anthem. But Bobby Darin's world collapsed when a shocking revelation forever altered his life.
Oh, the shark, babe, has such teeth, dear.
By 1968, Bobby Darin had overcome a weak heart and childhood illness to become a famed singer and award-winning actor. He'd grown up in a poor but loving Bronx, New York home with his mother Polly and sister Nina. And in 1968, it was Nina who could no longer hide the truth from Darin. The story was this. When he was 32 years old, Nina, the woman he had known his whole life as his devoted, if much older, sister, revealed to Bobby in a Las Vegas hotel room that she was, in fact, his mother. A secret she had kept from the entertainer his entire life. In 1936, Nina had become pregnant by a boyfriend, but unwed teenage mothers were unheard of in their tight-knit Italian neighborhood. So Nina and Polly moved elsewhere until Bobby was born, and then raised him as Polly's son and Nina's brother to avoid scandal. Darin's world was understandably shattered, and his relationship with Nina never fully recovered. But the entertainer went on to make music and films for another 5 years before dying during heart surgery in 1973. Some say he had never recovered from what had been the most shocking moment of his life. Sunday, August 30th, 1992, England's Mammoth Reading Festival. A day that will be remembered for something other than music. Here comes England's annual Reading Festival features performances by some of rock's biggest names. In 1992, by the time the all-female grunge band L7 reached the stage, the crowd was anxious and wet. They responded to the band's performance with heckling and mud throwing. Finally, fed up with the situation, singer Danita Sparks turned around, reached into her underpants, and pulled out her blood-soaked tampon. She then threw it into the crowd with the cry of, "Eat my used tampon."
That's just bloody vile.
I think that's
bloody vile.
Oh, at the end of the day, I think you go to see a show for entertainment. You don't want a tampon thrown in your face.
It was like all at once saying, like, "I'm a woman, deal with it." And then on the other hand going, like, "I'm a woman, back away. I can disgust you just as much as a man."
As startling as this incident was, the really shocking thing is someone actually threw the tampon back.
L7 kept on shocking. They even staged a raffle where the lucky winner got to have sex with one of the band's roadies. Next up, a Rolling Stone robs the cradle.
Well, Picasso had an even larger age span, didn't he? He was 94 and his wife was 37, I think.
And Vanilla Ice pays up.
I needed to wear a diaper on that day. I was very scared.
When the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll continues, it's been known as a rough business. But one music mogul may have taken the gangster tactics to new heights when Vanilla Ice crossed his path.
In 1990, Vanilla Ice was riding high with the success of Ice Ice Baby, until one of the industry's most notorious heavies claimed his artist was owed a piece of the action. The extreme, I rock a mic like a vandal, light up a stage and wax a chump like a candle. By the early 90s, Marion Suge Knight's Death Row Records was topping the charts with Snoop Dogg, Tupac, and Dr. Dre. But the label's success was often overshadowed by rumors of violence and intimidation. Suge's reputation was fueled by accounts of a 1990 incident when Chocolate, one of Suge's producers, claimed he'd written the hit Ice Ice Baby.
Chocolate called Suge and said, my hit song is on the radio and on video and I haven't been paid. Can you help me? If there was a problem, yo, I'll solve
it. Check out the hook while my DJ revolves it. Suge tried to get Vanilla to pay Chocolate for writing the song. But when Vanilla avoided the record mogul, Suge tracked him down at his Los Angeles hotel room.
Yo, man, let's get out of here.
The stories of Suge's coercion of Vanilla Ice, alleged coercion, run the gamut from just patting him on the back and saying, "Give me the rights," or hanging him over the balcony, threatening his life.
Even Vanilla Ice has two versions of the story.
I had my bodyguards who had guns, and they had their people which had guns, and they had us outpowered and outnumbered. Suge took me out on the balcony, started talking to me personally. He had me look over the edge. I needed to wear a diaper on that day. I was very scared.
But a year later, Vanilla Ice denied there was any foul play.
Suge and I have no problems, and I want everybody to know that. You know, he never beat me up or hung me over a balcony or none of that. So it was just basically, you know, he wanted some points. I figured the whole deal out, and, you know, I gave them to him.
Word to your mother.
Whatever happened that night, Vanilla signed over a portion of the publishing to Chocolate and Suge.
I guess if I wanted to play, I had to pay, and that's what I did.
Vanilla never repeated the success of his mega hit. And in 1997, Suge was sentenced to 9 years in prison on charges of battery and assault with a deadly weapon. He was released in April 2001.
This is a really smart man who just made a mistake. That's it. Don't turn him into that mythic figure that drinks himself to death or, you know, jumps off a building. It's a much more interesting character.
Throughout the 80s, INXS and their charismatic lead singer Michael Hutchence dominated the pop charts around the world. By the early 90s, the band's luck began to run out, and in 1993, Hutchence was hit by a taxi in Denmark. The accident caused him to lose 80% of his sense of taste and smell. It also left him with a minor crack in his skull and severe depression.
He was a different person. He was
very quick to anger, and it wasn't the Michael I knew. He had changed from when he got his bump on his head.
As record sales slumped, Michael retreated from the public eye. But by 1997, things were beginning to look up for Hutchins. INXS was planning their 20th anniversary tour, and he was engaged to girlfriend Paula Yates, with whom he had a daughter, Tiger Lily.
He seemed very happy, actually. I mean, he never stopped talking about Tiger. The light of his life was Tiger Lily.
But no one was prepared for what was about to happen. On November 22, 1997, Michael Hutchins was found dead in a hotel room in Sydney, Australia, of an apparent suicide, hanging by his belt in a doorway.
The phone rang, and this reporter said, would you like to comment about Michael? And I said, what do you mean, the tour or what? He said, oh, and he hung up. And I just went cold. And just as I left the room there, there's a knock at the front door, and the police came. I just couldn't believe it.
While friends and family mourned their loss, rumors quickly spread. Tabloid reports claimed Hutchins had accidentally choked to death during a sex act, or that he'd killed himself while distraught over a recent argument with Paula Yates' ex-husband, Bob Geldof. In the end, a coroner's report found traces of cocaine, Prozac, and alcohol in Michael's bloodstream, and ruled the death a suicide by hanging.
Very hard to come to grips with. Such a waste, you know, such a great talent.
There's only two people in the world who will actually know what happened that night, and that's Michael and God.
I'll mourn him for the rest of my life.
Rolling Stones bassist Bill Wyman had lived the single life for almost 20 years. But when he met London party girl Mandy Smith, he knew it was time to settle down. There was only one problem. She was 14. After 5 years of dating, Bill and Mandy were married just after her 19th birthday.
Well, Picasso had an even larger age span, didn't he? He was 94 and his wife was 37, I think. That worked.
At the time, 52-year-old Wyman admitted he had slept with over 1,000 women, but swore he'd put all that behind him.
We've made a vow and that's it. Tore up the address book. Everything's gone.
You've thrown your phone book away?
Yeah.
The whole lot?
Everybody's been trying to buy it off me. They were asking me if I was going to auction it at Sotheby's.
Most friends wished them well.
I wish him lots of luck. I think it's a very good idea he got married.
I'm glad he's finally taken the plunge.
Others weren't so sure.
I don't think he's a good match. I said I'm happy for him. But I don't know anything about it.
Do you think he's settled down?
That's another story, I don't know. They'll think I'm your dad.
And after just a few weeks of marriage, Bill left on a year-long tour with the Stones. Mandy spent most of her time in and out of hospitals for eating disorders. The couple divorced less than 2 years later. But the story didn't end there. A few years later, in a shocking twist, Bill Wyman's 30-year-old son was engaged to Mandy's 46-year-old mother. They didn't make it to the altar, but had they gone through with it, Bill Wyman would have been his ex-wife's step-grandfather.
When we come back, a diva fights for her life.
My spinal cord was resting on a sliver of bone that was it was razor sharp.
And Studio 54 gets busted.
I don't want to mention any names, so don't ask me. But everybody you ever heard of. Doing everything you ever imagined.
Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. So let's stay. In the last days of disco, people were shocked, I mean shocked, to learn that there were drugs in New York's most notorious nightclub. But it was an even more shocking revelation that brought down Studio 54.
It was the right place at the right time, with all the right people. But ego, greed, and a drug-fueled sense of invincibility led to the downfall of Studio 54 and to the end of the disco era. It was the world's most infamous nightclub, run by Steve Rebell and Ian Schrager. Once inside the vaunted velvet ropes, guests reveled in an anything-goes atmosphere, saturated with disco music, drugs, and famous faces.
I don't want to mention any names, so don't ask me. But everybody you ever heard of, doing everything you ever imagined.
But all the bold-faced names in the papers drew unwanted attention from the government. And when co-owner Steve Rebell gave an interview for a 1978 magazine article, the lights went up on America's biggest party.
And he made a statement that we make so much money, only the mafia makes more, but I better not talk because the IRS might hear it.
They did. IRS agents raided Studio 54 on December 14, 1978. They found cocaine, a double set of accounting books, and close to $1 million in undeclared cash.
The success was sort of overwhelming. It was really just try and hold on and make sure you don't get intoxicated, although we did and made some mistakes.
Steve and Ian's mistakes cost them a year in prison. With the help of lawyer Roy Cohn, a studio regular, they exposed some fellow nightclub owners and cut a deal with prosecutors. But the bust had effectively ended the decadent days of Studio 54. So let's
dance. They reopened it briefly, and that was kind of fun, but that was just really a nostalgia trip then. It was over. And I don't know that we ever really got anything back like that.
The Black Crowes had long hair. So did their Amorica album cover. Guess which one got a haircut?
Did you ever hear the one about last year?
While recording the 1994 album that was to become Amorica, the Black Crowes came up with an idea for the cover, a photo from the 1976 bicentennial issue of Hustler magazine.
The first title with that cover was Stick Out Your Corkscrew with the Black Crowes. That was going to be the name of the album. And we all loved it.
The title was later changed to the less controversial Amorica, but the patriotic photo remained.
I think the Black Crowes wouldn't see that there would be any problem with this because they see themselves very much as an American band, and there's the flag, and they put it on top of something that they love and care very much about.
The cover caused an outrage. Chain stores like Walmart and Kmart refused to carry the risque album cover. So the Black Crowes created an alternate cover with the hair trimmed out. But the band wasn't happy with the newly groomed photo.
It's okay for us to sort of show guns and show rap videos of people killing each other or show violence every day on TV and show all that shit. But to show a woman's pubic hair is like so offensive, it's not even funny.
Despite or because of the controversy, Amorica debuted in the top 10. Although the album went gold, it quickly dropped off the charts. She was the most successful crossover artist in Latin music history, but in one devastating moment, Gloria Estefan almost lost it all. On March 20th, 1990, a tractor trailer struck Gloria Estefan's tour bus, nearly crippling the singer.
The accident happened on snow-covered Interstate 380. She was rushed by ambulance to nearby Community Medical Center in Scranton, where doctors say she suffered a broken back.
They knocked me out of my shoes. That's how hard they hit us. Gloria tells me, I broke my back. What happened? I broke my back. I cannot move my legs.
My spinal cord was resting on a sliver of bone that was razor sharp. If we moved me, there was a risk of severing the cord, which then is no going back.
Gloria was airlifted to a top New York hospital.
This was a major spinal injury, and we needed to move promptly, we needed to move quickly.
Luckily, doctors were able to repair her spinal injury, paving the way for an amazing recovery. Coming out of the
dark. This has been one, if not the most difficult thing I've had to go through in my life. I've been overwhelmed with the love and concern that you've all shown me, and I will work as hard as I can to come back 100%.
Gloria endured months of painful rehabilitation and made a triumphant return to the spotlight.
And tonight she's back for her very first public performance. Ladies and gentlemen, the American Music Awards, welcome back with love, Gloria Estefan.
She made her first public appearance since the crash at the American Music Awards in 1991.
That was probably one of the saddest times of my whole life. But one thing that I learned from her, that she's an amazing woman. She's an amazing woman.
That finishes another hour of the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll. But hold on, it gets even more shocking from here. There are still 60 of rock's most shocking moments to go, and in the next hour, we will reveal 20 more. I'm Mark McGrath. Take care.
It was the most humiliating ordeal of my life.
I must do sock man today.
F*** to me doesn't necessarily mean gay people.
If someone's waving their genitalia at you, you don't automatically assume that they're an officer of the law.
Gary Glitter has been charged with child pornography.
Listen, fire in the house now.
I'm only 13 years old.
I love you. Michael Hutchence was found a hanging.
Who brought a chicken to the concert?
Guy, it was covered in blood.
I have two warrants for Jim Morrison.
Were you high?
High off a gun.
I was followed in the car, and my phone was tapped.
Cobain was killed by a shotgun blast.
I'm going home.
Die, 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 pig, die. Catchy little number, isn't it?
There were bodies laying everywhere.
Had nothing to do with a shooting.
Come on!
This is VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. I'm Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray. There are rock stars who try to shock us, and then there are rock stars who shock us just by being themselves. In this hour, we'll look at both kinds. VH1 has come up with a list of the 100 most shocking moments in rock history. We're counting them down, and we got 60 to go. We start this hour with a rap group whose lyrics reached new heights of nastiness. Their 1989 album got plenty of play, but a lot of it was in the courtroom.
You know, I was the first person to do explicit lyrics on rap records. Next thing you know, I'm a defender of the First Amendment.
When 2 Live Crew's album As Nasty As They Wanna Be debuted in Broward County, Florida, teenagers weren't the only ones listening.
I am like a dog in heat.
226 uses of the F word.
Up and down.
87 descriptions of oral sex. 15 uses of hoe.
Me so horny, me so horny, me so horny.
Broward County officials took the album to a judge who ruled it obscene.
After the court came down with its decision, all hell broke loose.
A federal judge in Florida has ruled that some of their songs are obscene.
As Nasty As They Wanna Be was now banned in the USA. It was illegal to buy, sell, or even perform songs from the album. Police raided stores selling the record.
Fort Lauderdale authorities arrested store owner Charles Freeman. He had refused to stop selling the group's best-selling album, As Nasty As They Wanna Be.
2 Live Crew appealed the obscenity ruling and took matters into their own hands. The band organized a concert and performed the illegal songs in protest. After the show, they were charged with obscenity for singing their own songs.
It was a fight, and I knew if they got me, they'd have killed the whole rap industry.
The Court of Appeals eventually overturned the obscenity decision and cleared 2 Live Crew of all the charges.
Verdict: the defendant is not guilty.
I don't think any other musician in this century
has had this kind of effect on the law that that Luke had.
The flap certainly had an effect on Two Live Crew record sales. The album went platinum and sold over 1 million copies in just 4 months. He was one of rock's most notorious bad boys. But in 1977, his penchant for excess almost led to the end of the Rolling Stones. In February 1977, the Rolling Stones went to Toronto to record tracks for a new album, where they caught the eye of Margaret Trudeau, wife of the Canadian Prime Minister.
Maggie Trudeau was chasing them, you know, like a groupie.
It was reported that Mrs. Trudeau was hanging out partying with the Stones.
They were smart enough to realize that letting the Prime Minister's wife in probably really wasn't going to go over really big with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police.
And it didn't. On February 27th, 1977, 15 Canadian Mounties raided Keith's hotel room and found an ounce of heroin. Keith was charged with possession of a controlled substance with intent to traffic. If convicted, he faced 7 years to life in prison.
I kissed it all off at that point. When they dragged me off, man, I said bye-bye to the kids, the family, the band. Well, I'll see you in about 7 years.
But the court was looking for a way out of a delicate political situation and found it when a young blind woman came forward to defend Keith's character.
There was this blind woman in Canada, and he used to arrange for her to get rides to the show, and she went to the judge.
Equally shocking was the judge's ruling. The judge gave Keith a 1 year suspended sentence, a year's probation, and ordered him to perform a benefit concert for the blind.
He would have done some serious time, had it not been for this woman.
They were looking for a diplomatic way out of this situation. After all, the Prime Minister's wife was involved. Anybody that get busy for an ounce of smack in the hotel room and get sentenced to a concert for the blind, that's got to be in the Guinness Book of Records.
She was the super groupie for some of rock and roll's biggest superstars, and she turned the tables on them, which she kissed and told. In 1987, Pamela DeBar released her autobiography, I'm With the Band, Confessions of a Groupie, a tell-all tale of rock and roll excess.
I wanted to have sex with rock stars, and I did. Yeah. Mick Jagger, Chris Hillman, Noel Redding, Jimmy Page, Hendrix,
oh gosh,
Keith Moon, Jim Morrison, Ray Davies.
It was a lengthy list, and Pamela's book was filled with fond and often funny recollections of the rock stars whose company she'd enjoyed, like Jim Morrison.
He was a poetic, gentle spirit. Looking up at that face was like, it's, you know, one of the wonders of the world, you know, no doubt.
Or Keith Moon.
He would do anything. He would play roles. We did a lot of role-playing sexually in every other kind of way.
As Pamela made clear in her book, it wasn't all about sex, drugs, and rock stars.
It's like being able to actually touch the God, right? To being able to communicate with the gods. When I would spend time with these people, I would want to go out and do my own creative things. I got inspired.
Though the book was on the New York Times bestseller list for 9 weeks, DeBar was often called immoral, or even worse. But Pamela remained unrepentant about her rock and roll escapades.
I don't care what anybody thinks. I went after what I wanted, and I got it. So Gloria Steinem can just go jump in the lake. Shame for me, yeah. I
wanna be your best old man. Next, Sly Stone gets married.
Where are you being married, Sly?
The garden, Madison Square Garden.
And Grace Slick gets drunk.
You don't need anybody, no.
Here's one example of why you shouldn't drink.
When VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll continue. The 1970s were a strange trip for Sly Stone. When he announced he was getting married, it looked like he might be settling down, but the wedding turned out to be the strangest trip of all.
When Sly Stone decided to marry his girlfriend, he envisioned a lavish wedding attended by his closest friends and relatives, all 20,000 of them. It's a family affair. It's a family Sly and the Family Stone were at the top of the charts in the early 70s. But by 1974, Sly's drug problem was getting worse, and the band's popularity began to wane. Ticket sales were slow for their June show at New York's Madison Square Garden. When Sly called his manager and told him he was getting married, they came up with a plan.
Where are you being married, Sly?
The Garden, Madison Square Garden.
That definitely helped ticket sales. Sly would marry his girlfriend, Kathy Silva, during the Madison Square Garden performance. The wedding took place on June 5th, 1974. The wedding party's coordinated outfits were designed by Halston. Sly's ushers were Soul Train's Don Cornelius and ABC News correspondent Geraldo Rivera.
I must have been just as screwed up as he was because I accepted the invitation to be part of the wedding.
Sly Stone, Sylvester Stewart, and Kathy Silva. I pronounce you your husband and wife in the name of the party.
That was lavish and extravagant and just as extraordinary as the man himself.
But wedded bliss for Sly and his bride was short-lived. Kathy Silva filed for divorce less than 5 months later.
It's a family affair.
It's a family affair.
Jefferson Airplane typified the psychedelic sensibility of the 1960s. But by the late 70s, band tensions and rampant alcohol and drug abuse were bringing the group in for a crash landing. Lead singer Grace Slick kicked off Jefferson Starship's 1978 European tour by getting too drunk to perform at the band's gig in Lorelei, Germany, causing angry fans to trash the stage and beat crew members bloody.
Whoa!
It was a tough act to follow, but Slick lived up to the challenge the following night in Hamburg by consuming the entire contents of her hotel room minibar.
That night I come to the gig, I come walking in, you know, and everybody's like, and sure enough, Grace is drunk out of her mind.
Grace was so drunk, she began by giving the German audience an impromptu history lesson.
Who won the war?
She followed that up with some distinctive vocal stylings.
You don't need anybody, no.
Grace is just a drunken fool. You know, here's one example of why you shouldn't drink.
I have a hard-on.
She was drunk, boy. And the audience, you know, Grace was like attacking the audience.
You ass!
The audience got up and they started to leave, you know, at first. And then they turned around and they came back and they sat down. They were going to watch this swan song. It was an embarrassing night.
So embarrassing, in fact, that Grace Slick immediately quit the band and returned to the States.
It was a tragedy rock fans will never forget. The horrifying accident at Curtis Mayfield's last concert.
He was one of soul music's most prolific artists, a singer, songwriter, and champion of civil rights. But a freak accident changed his life forever. In the 60s, Curtis Mayfield led the Impressions to enormous success by incorporating urban commentary into soul music. In the 70s, he achieved even greater fame as a solo artist. Mayfield's career cooled off in the 80s, but by 1990, he was poised for a comeback. On August 13th, he was set to perform at an outdoor concert in New York.
I walked up the backstage with my guitar, ready to perform, took about three steps toward the front, and I guess the lights went out.
A violent gust of wind ripped through the stage, knocking down the 500-pound lighting rig. It fell on Curtis, crushing three of his vertebrae. Mayfield suffered permanent damage. He would spend the rest of his life confined to a wheelchair, paralyzed from the neck down.
I guess the first thing set in was, this is a crisis. The important thing is that I don't allow myself to die.
Curtis had a capacity of never seeming to feel sorry for himself.
I've never asked why me. I've never cried about it. This is the worst thing that could have ever happened to me, and life still goes on.
Mayfield suffered through 9 years of round-the-clock care. Despite failing health, he managed to record a new album from a hospital bed in the studio.
I think it became an embarrassing lesson for many of us that had so much more to work with and did so much less with it.
Faith is the key.
Open the doors and board them.
In March of 1999, Curtis Mayfield was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but the singer was too ill to attend the ceremony. 9 months later, he died of complications from his accident. They were one of the biggest boy bands in the world, with millions of records sold and screaming fans everywhere they went. But they weren't in sync with their manager and said goodbye to their record label. When boy band Svengali Lou Pearlman signed NSYNC in 1996, he schooled them at his Florida training camp in the mold of his multi-platinum act, the Backstreet Boys. There he taught the would-be pop stars the ins and outs of superstardom.
We learned a lot from Lou just in the beginning. Just talking over, like, percentages and how things work, how management deals work, how record deals work.
You got no choice. He taught them well. By 1999, the group had sold more than 10 million records. But the NSYNC boys soon realized that the percentages were not going in their favor. Pearlman's contract with the band entitled him to 80% of their merchandising and 71% of their tour money and 50% of their recording royalties and all of their record company advances and a further 25% off the top as their manager and an additional commission as their business manager. In total, NSYNC had generated $300 million, but the band only received $7
million. It's tearing up my heart when I'm with you.
In September of 1999, NSYNC tore up their contract and left Lou Pearlman and record label RCA to sign with rival Jive Records. And then the lawsuits came. Pearlman and distributor BMG hit the group with a $150 million breach of contract suit. NSYNC countersued, and everyone went to court.
We certainly raised a substantial issue as to the fairness of these contracts and whether they were overreaching and whether they were obtained in breach of duty.
I think it's heartbreaking that we have to go through this. It's a legal system, and unfortunately, sometimes you have to go through a legal system.
The legal wrangling held up the release of the boy band's second full-length album, the pointedly titled No Strings Attached. But in the end, both sides avoided trial with an out-of-court settlement that paved the way for the album's release. And legal delays didn't hurt the band. The album has sold over 10 million copies.
When we return, Snoop Dogg's murder rap. And Chuck Berry's toilet tapes.
I mean, watching people pee, you know, it's not so bad, right? I mean, hell, I can live with that.
When the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll continues. Chuck Berry's image has never been squeaky clean, but no one was prepared for what police discovered in the bathroom of a St. Louis restaurant.
Chuck Berry has had his share of scrapes with the law, but he nearly flushed his career down the toilet when his private video collection became public. In June 1990, DEA agents raided Chuck Berry's home and found 62 grams of marijuana. They also discovered videotapes allegedly made with hidden cameras of women using the restroom in Berry's Southern Air restaurant.
He's a little perverted, you know, what the heck? I mean, watching people pee, you know, it's not so bad, right? I mean, hell, I could live with that.
The question is, did he open that restaurant solely to get the bathroom cam going? Probably.
Berry was charged with possession of a controlled substance, and since three of the girls on the videos were underage, he was also charged with child abuse.
There was always a certain amount of weird edge around Chuck Berry, as perverse and sort of kinked out as this incident was. Not like Chuck Berry's image was squeaky clean.
The child abuse charges were later dropped, and the felony drug charges were reduced.
They came to the conclusion that there wasn't sufficient evidence to go forward with the child abuse charges, and that's very important to us, and especially to Chuck, that everybody knows that he has been totally cleared of those charges.
Under a plea bargain, Berry agreed to serve 2 years of probation on a misdemeanor charge of marijuana possession. Through it all, Chuck Berry maintained his innocence.
Well, I'm not a bad boy. I'm a...
Thank you.
Iggy Pop's notorious live performances with the Stooges often included rubbing himself with peanut butter, diving into the audience, exposing himself, and self-mutilation. But one night, he went too far. In 1973, Iggy Pop and the Stooges were booked to play a concert at Max's Kansas City in New York.
But what actually happened was there were tables in the front row of Max's, and he was walking from table to table, and he went down. And when he went down, he knocked a glass off that cut him in his chest.
I got cut on the bottom of a broken off cocktail glass on the stem.
It was a very deep cut.
And there was a lot of blood.
So it was spurting blood out.
And I didn't notice it at first. I just kept singing along.
And of course, Iggy being Iggy, you know, he just got up and continued performing.
And the more I sang and the more I moved, the more the blood pumped.
This jet of blood, you know, was spewing forth and, you know, drenching everybody, you know, in the front rows.
I looked down and I was covered in blood and
When people were turning their heads and trying not to look, he saw the reaction he got out of them, and I think he liked it.
Fueled by the audience's response, Iggy was out of control, but the show had to be stopped.
They did stop the show at Max's, and Alice Cooper was the one who took Iggy's side and said, listen, you got to go to the doctor and get this sewed up.
We literally had to wrap him up in a towel and take him to the hospital.
Iggy recovered from the injury and continued to shock audiences with his performances.
I'm proud of everything I've done on stage. Everything.
Mr. Freed, did you ever accept payola to play a record?
No, I did not.
As the top DJ at WINS in New York, Alan Freed defied the musical taste of the old guard, replacing Bing Crosby with Bo Diddley and dropping Frank Sinatra for Little Richard.
If he played that record for you, it was a smash.
At the time, it was standard practice for record companies to give DJs money as incentive to play their records. It was known as payola.
A lot of people were accepting money for playing records. Freed was kind of an anomaly because sometimes there could be a $100 bill stuck in a single, and if he didn't like the record, he wouldn't touch it.
Over the years, Freed had been targeted by anti-rock groups for playing racially mixed music.
The religious organizations, the government organizations frowned upon Alan Freed playing mainly black music. He's going to divide this country with this kind of music, and he's doing it now. The moment payola came into the picture, they saw their chance to get Alan Freed off the air.
In 1959, when the government began hearings on payola practices among top DJs, they focused on Alan Freed.
People came out from the woodwork saying they gave Alan this, they gave Alan that. They got him investigated.
There were a lot of people who admitted to the Senate committee that they took 10 times what Freed ever took, and nothing ever happened to those people at all.
While many of the DJs were able to prove that their business practices were legal, Alan Freed was not.
They hit Alan with like 26 counts of commercial bribery, receiving money to play records. One day he was the king of rock and roll, the biggest thing going, and the next day he was off the air.
Freed pled guilty and was fined only $300, but alcohol abuse ruined his remaining years, and he died in 1965.
We're up to number 50. The second half of our countdown begins with the story of a reggae legend who was nearly killed for his beliefs.
In 1976, Bob Marley's fame had grown to mythic proportions, but his politically charged songs almost cost him his life. In the midst of a violent election campaign between Jamaica's prime minister and his right-wing opponent, Bob Marley agreed to lend his enormous popularity to a free concert for the prime minister 10 days before the election.
1976 in Jamaica, it was felt that Bob Marley's endorsement of a political candidate could actually shift that campaign to that candidate.
While Marley insisted that he did not endorse either candidate, the right-wing opposition claimed that Marley's performance was politically motivated. And on the night of December 3rd, someone tried to stop him.
These men jumped out with guns and started spraying everybody in sight. They shot Bob, who was in his home, across the chest and across his arm, and then fled into the night.
Because the assassination attempt coincided with the upcoming election, it was widely rumored that the attack was political. Some even accused the CIA, who backed the opposition, of interfering.
I do believe that the people that the CIA influenced, directed, and armed were responsible for the shooting of Bob Marley.
Miraculously, everyone survived the attack. And on December 5th, Marley performed at Prime Minister Michael Manley's concert as scheduled. The Prime Minister won re-election 10 days later.
Get up, stand up, Didier, stand up for your right one more time.
The fact that the gunman came and shot him point blank and missed killing him by a millimeter, the bullet went right across his heart, meant that there was a protective force around Bob Marley, and that made Bob the subject of myth.
Don't give up the fight.
He was the musical genius behind the Beach Boys, but his increasingly erratic and paranoid behavior eventually gave way to a complete collapse. Brian Wilson had a unique gift for harmony, melody, and arrangement, but he also bore the mental scars of an abusive childhood.
As time went on, he became more and more vulnerable, I guess to the point where he could no longer protect himself at all.
By December of 1964, at the height of the Beach Boys' popularity, drug use, band tensions, and the pressures of stardom were wearing Brian Wilson down. One night on a flight to Houston, Wilson finally snapped. 5 minutes after takeoff, he began screaming and stumbling around the plane. His bandmates were terrified. Wilson was hysterical for the entire flight. When they landed, Wilson announced he would no longer tour with the group. At first, the self-imposed studio exile seemed a healthy step. While the rest of the band continued to tour, Wilson began writing the group's classic 1966 album, Pet Sounds. But Wilson's condition worsened, and he started behaving erratically. He built a giant sandbox around his grand piano and experimented freely with LSD. The outside world eventually became too much for Brian Wilson, and he spent the better part of 3 years in bed, a time immortalized by Canadian popstars Bare Naked Ladies in their song, Brian Wilson.
It's always shocking to find out that music that is so life-embracing and so beautiful can come from someone who is so damaged by such horrible things in their lives.
By 1977, Brian Wilson was well enough to rejoin the Beach Boys on stage, but he would still spend the next two decades in and out of various kinds of controversial therapy. Rapper Snoop Doggy Dogg almost got sent to the pound when his real life started imitating his art. When Calvin Brodus, aka Snoop Dogg, was unleashed onto the world in the early 90s, he had the rap sheet and the street credibility to become one of hip-hop's biggest stars.
Rolling in my 6'4". What all the homies saying?
But on August 25th, 1993, before he'd even finished his debut album, his past caught up with him.
A car drove by. Someone supposedly threw a gang sign at him, which is a direct challenge.
An argument followed, and Snoop, his friend Sean Abrams, and bodyguard McKinley Lee followed the car to Woodbine Park, where Lee allegedly fired the shots that killed 20-year-old Philip Woldemarium, an L.A. gang member. Snoop fled the scene, but not his budding career. 1 week later, and by this time wanted by the authorities, he boldly appeared on the MTV Video Music Awards.
Check this out, dog. Here the nominees for the best R&B fist video right here, though.
Snoop and his friend surrendered to the police after the MTV telecast. Lee admitted shooting Woldemarium, but claimed he'd acted only in self-defense. As the driver of the vehicle, Snoop was charged with murder and conspiracy and faced life in prison. The trial began in late 1995. After 2 months of testimony, the jury found that Snoop and Lee were in fact acting in self-defense and were acquitted of the murder charges.
Murder was the case that they gave me. I'm innocent.
we come back. A grunge goddess under fire.
Oh, make me over.
With Courtney, I don't know if the press has been unfair to her because she's done everything in her power to get so much coverage, but that's kind of her shtick.
And one of rock's most shocking marriages.
Nobody thought this would last.
Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. Michael Jackson is the king of pop, so it's only fitting he chose another king's daughter for his queen. But it turned out there was trouble in pop paradise.
Some called it true love. Others called it the ultimate publicity stunt. It was a celebrity marriage made for the tabloids. On May 26, 1994, Michael Jackson married Lisa Marie Presley, officially becoming Elvis Presley's son-in-law.
I'm all shook up,
The secret wedding took place in the Dominican Republic and was kept under wraps for almost 3 months, until Lisa Marie announced it to the world.
I don't know if America really believed it, but they loved it.
But the fantasy had some flaws. The marriage was largely seen as a PR stunt to repair Michael's tarnished image.
He had gone through this whole allegations of the molestation. I mean, it could only help him, you know, to get married.
Don't stop till you get enough.
Lisa Marie was rumored to want her own career in music and reportedly wanted to get Michael and his money into the Church of Scientology, of which she was a member.
You could either look at it as like this sort of after-school special where everything's perfect and it's great and they're happy, or you can look at it as like the master PR move to make them both look really normal.
At the MTV Video Music Awards in 1994, the couple attempted to answer cynics.
Nobody thought this would last.
They tried again in 1995, releasing a video that was a little more revealing.
You were not alone.
Lisa Marie finally set the record straight in an interview with Diane Sawyer on Primetime Live. But the fairy tale came to an end in 1996, when Lisa Marie Presley Jackson filed for divorce.
What about us, girl?
He was the ultimate showman of the 70s glam rock scene, in his silver foil cat suit and bouffant wig. But it was his perverse preferences offstage that really got him into trouble. In November 1997, Gary Glitter took his computer to PC World for servicing. The technician repairing the machine found computer files containing over 4,000 pornographic photos of children. He immediately called the police. When Glitter returned for the computer, he was arrested on the spot.
Veteran pop star Gary Glitter has been charged with 50 offenses relating to child pornography after being questioned by police for several hours.
A search of his London home and other addresses also revealed a private library of material downloaded from websites. Some of the photos revealed young girls being tortured, tied up, gagged, and blindfolded.
On November 12, 1999, Glitter was sentenced to 4 months in prison after pleading guilty to 54 counts of producing pornographic material. With good behavior, he was released on parole after serving only 2 months. Upon his release, Glitter publicly apologized for his actions.
I deeply regret doing what I was sent to prison for. I've served my time. I want to put it all behind me and live my life.
But the 61-year-old singer remains listed on Britain's Register of Dangerous Sex Offenders until the year 2006. And 3 months after his release, Glitter packed his bags and moved to Cuba.
There's nothing shocking about a rock star who doesn't like how they're portrayed in the press. But in 1992, one artist gave an interview so damaging that she almost lost custody of her daughter.
It was the magazine article that made Courtney Love a poster child for bad parenting and threatened to tear apart America's first family of grunge. In the early 90s, the Seattle Sound ruled the land. Nirvana's Kurt Cobain was king, and Hole's Courtney Love is queen. Love was openly courting the media when a 1992 Vanity Fair profile made her a lightning rod for controversy.
Courtney was just raw. I mean, there was like no facade going on there. There was no apologies. It was just straight in your face. And I think it really flipped people out.
There was scandal on every page. The article played up the fact that the visibly pregnant Love smoked during her interview. But the biggest bombshell was the article's allegation that Love used heroin while pregnant. Love herself alluded to a January 1992 drug binge, a time when she would have been 2 months pregnant with daughter Frances Bean Cobain, who was born in August of that same year. Though Frances was born healthy, she was taken away from the couple as authorities launched an investigation into their fitness as parents. Love ultimately admitted to past drug use, but said it happened only while she was unaware of her pregnancy.
I am the parts.
Courtney was devastated by an onslaught of negative reaction. She said the magazine had violated her life, and the episode became the first of many in Courtney's love-hate relationship with the media.
With Courtney, I don't know if the press has been unfair to her because she's gotten so much coverage. And she's done everything in her power to get so much coverage. But that's kind of her shtick.
Oh, make me over.
Courtney would go on to take control of her image before others had the chance. And in 1995, she reappeared in Vanity Fair, this time on the cover and without scandal. Keith Moon was as famous for his rock and roll lifestyle as he was for the aggressive and inspired drumming he brought to The Who. But in January of 1970, Moon's antics took a lethal turn. He was known as Moon the Loon, and he was the heart and soul of The Who.
He lived for The Who. He lived for that glory. You know, he was at his peak in a way, in the peak eras of rock and roll, in the peak eras of the rock star, the excess.
But Keith's madcap laughs were interrupted on the night of January 4th, 1970, when he appeared in a new pub, which attracted a rough crowd.
Keith was asked to open this place, and there were a crowd of skinheads.
As the evening wore on, the crowd became agitated and increasingly angry at the celebrity millionaire in their midst. Keith and his entourage tried to leave in his Rolls Royce.
They were heckling and yelling, and as we were leaving, they all tried to converge on us, and then they were all piled on the car.
Trying to help, Keith's chauffeur Neil Boland exited the car. During a skirmish with the crowd, Neil got caught underneath the Rolls Royce. Amid the panic and confusion, Keith tried to drive to safety, inadvertently killing Neil Boland, who was still trapped beneath the car. Although blood alcohol tests revealed Moon was intoxicated, a coroner ruled the death accidental, and he was eventually cleared of all charges. But Moon remained haunted by the incident until the end of his life.
It would often come up. Oh, how could I have done that? I'm a murderer. He was totally guilt-ridden about it.
The endless partying finally caught up to Keith Moon. After years of alcohol abuse, he died at age 31 in 1978.
When we come back,
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock.
The Happy Days theme song starts a riot.
Each one of them had a big stick or a bat in their hand.
It looked like a war going on.
And the Go-Go's get down and dirty on video.
This is going to be real interesting to show one day, huh?
Next on the 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. In the early 80s, the Go-Go's advanced the cause of equal opportunity for women in rock. They showed us that girls on tour can party just as hard as the boys, and there's a video to prove it.
In the early 1980s, the Go-Go's were queens of the MTV airwaves with such wholesome hits as Vacation and We Got the Beat. But there's one video in their repertoire they wish they'd never made. In 1981, the Go-Go's embarked on their Beautify America tour and started videotaping their sordid backstage antics.
It was on our very first tour. It was at the very beginning and started out kind of almost like slumber party pranks. You know, somebody passes out and you spray shaving cream on them.
But before long, the schoolgirl pranks gave way to adult entertainment as the girls wrangled their roadies into compromising positions.
David has to beat off. And you have to watch really intently, yes, like you're interested. Put your hand down.
It's just me and Belinda out of our minds on coke.
Then why can't girls off?
What?
This is going to be real interesting to show one day, huh?
Little did they know at the time just how many people would see the tape. The video was sold around the world as the Go-Go's sex tape, but some people may not have known what kind of bang they were getting for their buck.
It's not like you see naked Go-Go's cavorting around in bed with each other or with anybody else. And that's what people think they're getting when they buy this trash.
No matter who or what the video may have exposed, the Go-Go's just want to forget about it.
I often wish we could just sell it and give the money to charity, you know, so some good could come out of it.
It was high entertainment value.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7.
When Blackboard Jungle premiered in 1955, it shocked audiences with its blatant portrayal of juvenile delinquency. But it was the film's theme song that became the inadvertent anthem for teenage violence and rebellion around the world. As the theme song to Happy Days, Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock evoked a simpler time. But after the song premiered in Blackboard Jungle, it incited violent behavior on screen and off. By the time Bill Haley arrived in Berlin for a sold-out concert in 1958, German teenagers were ready to rock.
There were no signs of anything going to happen when we come out on the stage. Everything seemed perfectly normal.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock.
Normal until Haley and the Comets played Rock Around the Clock, sending kids into a frenzy.
They become so excited they jumped up on the stage and started dancing on the stage.
When police failed to gain control of the crowd, all hell broke loose.
The show stopped. I had a big baby grand piano and they turned it over and pulled all the keys off and destroyed it.
It looked like a war going on.
Each one of them had a big stick or a bat in their hand. Just in a violent mood, those kids.
Bill said, we had to get out of here because it got out of hand.
In the end, 17 people were injured and 18 were arrested. Haley and the Comets escaped unharmed, but their reputation was permanently damaged.
Forever after, Haley was associated with the problems of juvenile delinquency.
Public Enemy rose to fame rapping about racism and social injustice. But when one of their own was accused of anti-Semitism, it threatened to tear the group apart.
Fight the power! We've got to fight the powers that be! Come on!
Yo, check this out, man!
In a May 1989 interview with Washington Times reporter David Mills, Public Enemy's Professor Griff made anti-Semitic comments that caused an uproar.
We don't talk about how the Jews finance these experiments on AIDS with black people in South Africa. How come we don't talk about those things? The Jews are wicked, and we can prove this.
Hold it now! Come on!
Newspapers around the country picked up the story, and Griff's comments heightened tensions between black and Jewish communities.
Here we go again!
Don't believe the hype!
Frankly, no important black figure in America has put Professor Griff in his place.
The Jews don't preach hatred to the blacks, and the blacks shouldn't teach hatred to the Jews.
Today, Professor Griff denies he made the comments.
So you didn't say that? You didn't?
No.
The Jews are wicked, and we can prove this.
Definitely not in that context.
Yes, Jews. Yes.
To say the majority of Jews are wicked, that's crazy.
Oh, wait a minute.
The resulting furor forced Chuck D to kick Griff out of the group.
We tried to deal with Professor Griff's problems internally, but we were unsuccessful. Consequently, as of today, Professor Griff is no longer a member of Public Enemy. And I'm sad to say, but that's the way it has to be.
On June 27th, Def Jam Records announced the indefinite hiatus of Public Enemy. They regrouped about 5 weeks later, and Griff was brought back into the group as the Supreme Allied Chief of Community Relations, not available for interviews.
Well, that's all for this hour, people. But if you can handle more, and I think you can, hold on. Still to come are the final 40 of the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll. Until then, I'm Mark McGrath. This is VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. I'm Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray. Rock and roll has never attracted the modest or mild-mannered. Add a little sex and drugs to that mix, and the combination can be shocking. VH1 has come up with a list of rock's 100 most shocking moments. We're counting them down, we're up to number 40. We begin this hour with one hard-rocking band who took the X-rated backstage party to a whole new level.
On stage, they were the ultimate rock and roll showmen. Off stage, they forever raised the standard by which rock and roll excess would be judged. In 1979, Van Halen hit it big and hit the road. After the show, the band would rent entire floors of hotels for lavish parties. And it was not uncommon to find crew, groupies, and band members strolling the halls naked. But it was David Lee Roth's unique incentive plan to get the crew more involved that set this tour apart.
What I had said was to the crew, everybody gets 5 backstage passes, and if you go ahead and initial it, then whichever gal I wind up with, if it's got your initials on it and you gave her the backstage pass, you get $100.
By all accounts, Diamond Dave awarded many prizes during the 1979 tour. But all good things must come to an end.
David Lee Roth's whole thing was that he was just like this sex god, you know? Like, look at me. I'm sex god. I'm He-Man. I love him and leave him. Look at him now. He has no hair.
When he burst onto the hip-hop scene in 1996, he was hailed by critics as rap's great white hope.
Stop the tape. This kid needs to be locked away.
But it was his controversial lyrics that made the biggest headlines.
My name is... My name is...
Eminem's third full-length album, the Marshall Mathers LP, was released on May 23, 2000 and sold 1.7 million copies in its first week. The music earned rave reviews, but the content was condemned.
A lot of people were very offended by the lyrics, specifically gay and lesbian people, by the casual homophobia on that record.
On May 30th, the Gay and Lesbian Alliance issued a statement saying the record contained the most blatantly offensive homophobic content they'd seen in years.
Talking about violence against women and violence against gays is not responsible. That's the point. It is not a free speech issue.
But Eminem claimed his lyrics were not homophobic.
Faggot to me doesn't necessarily mean gay people. I mean, just like, you know, you might sit around in your living room and say, oh, dude, stop it. You're being a fag, dude. I'm Slim Shady, yes,
I'm the real Shady. By September, the record had sold more than 7 million copies. And at a Senate hearing on violence in the entertainment industry, Lynn Cheney, wife of Dick Cheney, singled out Eminem.
He is a violent misogynist. He advocates raping and murdering his mother in one of his songs. He glories in the same song in the idea that he might murder any woman he comes across.
A week before the Senate hearing, Eminem had won 3 MTV Video Music Awards, and he remained unapologetic about his lyrical content.
Every time a critic tries to slam me in the press or whatever, I sell more records, so I really want to thank you people. I get a lot of aggression out through my music. Instead of, like, doing things that I say I'm gonna do, I just say I'm gonna do them and then walk away from the mic feeling a lot better.
I'll defend to the death his ability to say whatever he wants to say. But if you're 11 years old, you know, and Eminem is rapping about butchering and killing and raping his wife, there's a good chance that that's going to set a really dangerous precedent. And to be honest with you, 11-year-olds are the people buying Eminem records.
At the 2001 Grammy ceremony, Eminem won 3 awards and performed a duet with Elton John. Outside, the controversy continued as gay and lesbian groups protested the event.
Damn.
They were friends and collaborators, but their friendship ended when Michael Jackson followed Paul McCartney's investment advice a little too closely. In 1969, after years of bad business decisions, the Beatles lost control of the publishing rights to their music. Years later, when the songs came up for sale, McCartney tried to buy back the Lennon-McCartney compositions. He even reached out to Yoko Ono for help. But even Paul McCartney couldn't come up with enough money to compete with his friend, Michael Jackson.
Paul McCartney told Michael Jackson it's a good idea to buy publishing rights. It's a very good investment. And Michael thought, gee, what would be the best publishing rights I could have? Ding, the Beatles.
He started to say after a couple of weeks, he said, I'm gonna buy your songs. And I thought, he's great, I love this guy, he's a great laugh, you know. Just beat it, beat it, beat it.
But McCartney wasn't laughing in 1985 when Jackson outbid him for the catalog to the tune of $47 million.
He just says, oh, that's business. And that's it. And I say, yeah, sure, it's business. But it's also friendship. It's also morals.
Their relationship got even worse in 1987 when Jackson sold the rights to the song Revolution to Nike for a sneaker commercial.
Songs like Revolution didn't mean a pair of sneakers. It meant revolution. It was an idea that became important to some people.
Jackson continues to license Beatles songs for use in commercials and earns millions from their sale. But McCartney has fared well on his own. In the year 2000, he topped the list of Britain's richest musicians.
When we come back, David Bowie trades his orange wig for a brown shirt.
He did a Nazi salute, or that's what they said at the time, and there was a huge scandal.
And Ice-T uncovers a secret about the police force.
They was just getting away with murder out there, literally. And I just said, what if somebody just got fed up with it and just went on a rampage?
Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll.
There goes the neighborhood!
He's one of rock's most stylish stars, but he shocked fans when he took a detour into fascist fashion.
David Bowie has always been known for reinventing himself. After his Ziggy Stardust phase, it seemed that nothing could shock fans. But Bowie had a surprise for them. In the 1970s, Bowie's interest in fascism landed him in trouble. In April 1976, he was detained by customs officers on the Russian-Polish border when they found Nazi memorabilia in his possession. Bowie claimed it was research material for a film on Nazi war criminals. A few weeks later, he made matters worse by reportedly saying he would like to be prime minister one day, adding, "I believe that Britain could benefit from a fascist leader." Then, on May 2nd, 1976, Bowie arrived at London's Victoria Station with a new look.
I was there when he came back from Berlin at Victoria Station.
Bowie stepped into an open-top Mercedes and gestured in a way that shocked several thousand waiting fans.
He did a Nazi salute, or he did a kind of, like a sort of, I don't want to say Nazi, but that's what they said at the time. There was a huge scandal.
Bowie claimed that the photographer caught him in mid-wave, but the British papers jumped on the incident and alleged that Bowie was indeed doing a Nazi salute.
We didn't see it like that. We didn't see it as a political thing. We just thought he was being kind of super cool, you know. His gestures always seemed to go with whatever he was wearing at the time.
I don't think they were Nazis. I think it was just, the rock stars at that time were playing with imagery. There is something really fascistic and evil about rock and roll. When it's done right, when rock and roll is done right, it is the devil's music.
Bowie soon turned his back on his fascist fashions and moved on to a new look.
I just really didn't care if I lived or died. I was addicted to everything that I could get in my veins, and that never ended for me until I did die.
Motley Crue was one of the biggest heavy metal bands of the 1980s, but years of living the rock and roll lifestyle left bass player Nikki Sixx with a devastating addiction to drugs and alcohol.
We want to snort all the drugs, and if mainlining is bad, then that's all we want to do.
One night, the party almost turned deadly. On December 23rd, 1987, Nikki Sixx and a couple of friends decided to go out for a night on the town.
I'd gotten some cocaine and had some Valiums and was very drunk. This drug dealer had showed up. I was so f***ed up, I said, go ahead and fix me.
Nikki was given a potentially lethal dose of heroin.
There I am, turning blue. And they all dragged me into the shower, stick ice cubes down my pants.
Nikki was unconscious and barely alive.
Paramedics get there, and my heart stopped. They basically covered my head with the blanket and said, he's gone. There's a moment that I see the ambulance and I see my body covered. I see this from above.
Paramedics found no heartbeat in Nikki, but administered two shots of adrenaline directly into his chest in a final attempt to revive him. The adrenaline revived Nicky, but even death itself couldn't stop his drug use.
I'd gotten home and cooked up the largest shot of heroin I've ever had and passed out.
Six finally made it to detox and overcame his addiction to drugs.
Here's some of the lyrics on Cop Killer. Die, 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 pig, die. F*** the police. Catchy little number, isn't it?
In 1992, Ice-T's rock-rap group Body Count released their self-titled debut album. The record's last track, Cop Killer, ignited a debate on police brutality and free speech.
I went into the rehearsal hall one day, and I was singing Psycho Killer by Talking Heads. And my drummer was like, man, they need a cop killer. I'm like, what you talking about? And he's like, man, these cops is out of pocket. They was just getting away with murder out there, literally. And I just said, what if somebody just got fed up with it and just went on a rampage?
One month after the album's release, riots broke out in Los Angeles in reaction to the Rodney King verdict. While the LAPD tried to contain the riots, they were once again accused of police brutality.
Something kind of just snapped and said, enough. We're not going to stand here and let someone put out a song that advocates the murder of police officers.
Police groups organized nationwide protests of Ice-T's label Warner Brothers and its parent company, Time Warner.
The cops were under fire for a lot of brutality. And by using that record, they were able to shift the energy from them to me.
Initially, Time Warner refused to pull Cop Killer off the album. But pressure from the public, the media, and Washington intensified.
They are making money off a record that is suggesting it's okay to kill cops, and that is wrong.
60 members of Congress who did sign a letter to Time Warner protesting. George Bush said the record was sick.
In July 1992, Ice-T asked Warner Brothers to re-release Body Count without the controversial song.
I was like, let's pull it off. We'll eliminate us as a target, and then we'll have to go back to real issues in the United States about something outside of a record.
I can't think of another single song that was as much of a lightning rod as Cop Killer was. Cop
Killer! It might be the strangest first date in history. John Lennon and Yoko Ono took off their clothes, made weird noises, and recorded an album. But it wasn't until that album hit the stands that things really got shocking.
We felt like two virgins, that's what the album was called. And we thought, to show everything, we just said, here, you know. And that was in 1968, and all hell broke loose.
On their first date in May of 1968, John Lennon and Yoko Ono spent the night at his recording studio, experimenting with strange tones and disjointed melodies.
Who's that?
Then they set up a camera and took some pictures.
It was a time of sexual revolution, and also to show that we were beautiful, we meaning not John and I, but the human race, you know.
John certainly was trying to find ways to push people's buttons. Obviously, you don't do that when you're in the biggest band in the history of the planet without realizing there's going to be attention and controversy.
When Two Virgins was released, the press and public were horrified. The few record stores that carried the album kept it behind the counter or wrapped in a brown paper bag.
They didn't scorn us for doing it, but they trashed us for not looking pretty.
Just 6 weeks after the album's release, police at Newark Airport seized a shipment of 30,000 records, claiming the Two Virgins cover was pornographic.
Parents wrote letters saying, put a stop to this. And then there's letters from J. Edgar Hoover saying, you know, the legal position of the Justice Department is that this does not violate the laws against obscenity.
Obscene or not, the album didn't sell. But that was beside the point for John and Yoko.
We wanted to say, this is me naked with the woman I love. You want to share it?
I'm so in love with you.
Al Green's sultry voice made his female fans swoon. But a scorned woman and a pot of grits convinced Green to trade his sensuality for spirituality.
Would you help me say less? Come on in. Let's stay together.
On the night of October 18th, 1974, Mary Woodson, Green's girlfriend of 3 months, wanted to take their relationship to the next level.
She asked me if I would marry her. I says,
Oh, no, I don't think I'm ready to get married.
Unwilling to take no for an answer, Woodson came up with a plan that would get Green's attention.
I went downstairs. I said, why are you boiling water? She said,
Green undressed and got into the shower. Moments later, Woodson burst through the bathroom door and heaved a pot of scalding hot grits on his back.
I seen this whole pot of water, and all of a sudden, I'm full of it. And then I reached back, man, and I got two fingers full of skin. I'm in total pain and shock.
After assaulting Green, Woodson fled to the bedroom where she committed suicide. The incident crystallized Green's need to change his life.
My soul and my heart were converted from the girls, from the champagne and wine, to more elevated things.
I just want to preach a little while today.
In 1976, Al Green became a Baptist minister.
I told my sister, I told my brother.
By the end of the decade, he had abandoned the world of R&B and devoted himself almost entirely to religious music.
One year I'm a rock star, the next year I'm a gospel preacher.
She was one-third of the hot hip-hop trio TLC, but for Lisa Left Eye Lopez, her music career wasn't the only thing on fire. In 1994, Lisa Lopez was living with her boyfriend, Atlanta Falcons star receiver Andre Rison, but their relationship was far from perfect.
Man, there were so many problems in our relationship, and we've had a lot of tussling matches. We had a lot of wrestling matches.
But one night, the couple's stormy relationship got out of hand. On June 9th, 1994, Rison came home late after a long night of partying and got into a confrontation with Lopez, who was drunk.
I was furious. I started screaming at Andre, slapping him. Next thing you know, he pulled me in the bedroom and we were a fight team. I threw a pair of sneakers in the tub and lit them.
But the fire got out of control.
I'm like, hello? Oh my God, turn on channel 5. Turn on channel 5.
Flames erupting at the $800,000 mansion.
Lisa, burn the house down.
Within minutes, the fire gutted the home and consumed its contents.
Lisa was charged with first-degree arson and damage to property.
Singer Lisa Lopez surrenders to police 32 hours after a suspected arson fire.
But she was able to forgo jail time for a stint at a detox center and 5 years probation. The fiery incident didn't destroy everything. While in detox, Lisa wrote some lyrics that would later become part of their biggest hit, Waterfalls.
Up next, James Brown races the cops.
Were you high?
High off of God.
And the Lizard King gets in touch with his lizard.
The artist should feel free to use nudity if he feels like it.
When VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll continues. By the late 60s, rock fans were used to their idols revealing their most personal emotions through their music. But one night in 1969, Doors frontman Jim Morrison allegedly revealed something more.
On March 1st, 1969, a sold-out crowd packed the Dinner Key Auditorium to see the Doors. They thought they'd get far-out psychedelia. Instead, they got chaos.
Wait!
Jim was drunk out of his mind at that show.
You're all a bunch of idiots!
The mood at the arena was surreal and menacing. One fan pushed a lamb on stage and fights broke out. And then, Morrison threatened to expose himself to the audience.
Jim did that whole thing about, you know, I'm gonna show it to you. But he never did it. You know, I don't think he ever did it. I never saw it.
But Miami police had had enough. They ended the concert, and although Morrison slipped away, he soon found himself a wanted man.
We have taken out two warrants for Jim Morrison. One of them is for indecent exposure. The other is for the use of obscene languages during his performance at Dinner Key Saturday night.
Morrison eventually turned himself into LA authorities and was charged with a felony. 16 states banned the Doors from ever performing again, and the incident became the focal point of a national debate over decency and artistic freedom.
I've heard that the Doors, they got kicked out of other places
because of the riots and their indecent exposure, and I feel that we have to do something about this. This is real disgusting.
I think there should be complete freedom for the artist and performer. The artist should feel free to use nudity if he feels like it.
On November 20th, 1970, Morrison was found guilty of indecent exposure and sentenced to 6 months hard labor. But he appealed the ruling and moved to France to await the trial.
America really just put it to him in Miami. They just screwed it into him. And I think that broke him, man. I think that's what maybe did it, you know? I think that was like the final straw.
9 months later, on July 3rd, 1971, Jim Morrison died in Paris of apparent heart failure. His appeal was still pending. He was rap's warrior poet, but his taste for the thug life ultimately proved tragic. Tupac Shakur was a profoundly talented rapper and actor, but at times his life seemed destined for a premature and tragic end.
Tupac lived to piss people off. He was an incredibly charismatic, incredibly complicated.
That's the way it is. Come on. Come on.
That's just the way it is.
In November 1994, he was shot 5 times in a New York recording studio. He survived, but believed he'd been set up and blamed rapper and former friend, the Notorious B.I.G. At the time, the rap community was sharply divided between East Coast and West Coast factions. The Notorious B.I.G. was signed to East Coast label Bad Boy, and Tupac, the West Coast-based Death Row Records, headed by Suge Knight, the controversial figure who was open about his affiliations with L.A. gangs.
You know what time it is. Westside.
On the night of September 7th, 1996, Tupac and Suge attended a Mike Tyson fight in Las Vegas and were involved in a wild brawl with a gang member in a casino lobby. It was a fight that may have set in motion the tragic events that were about to unfold. As Tupac and Suge headed to a post-fight party in Suge's BMW, a white Cadillac pulled up next to them at a downtown stoplight. Shots rang out. There was a hail of bullets. Tupac was hit 4 times. He died a week later in a Las Vegas hospital. Less than 6 months later, the Notorious B.I.G. was shot and killed as he left a Los Angeles party. Although neither killing has been solved, some see them as forever linked.
And it's crazy, it seems they'll never let up.
Tupac's murder and Biggie's murder are always going to be linked. It's sort of been written into history now as, you know, there was this one and then in retaliation there was this other. And we just still do not know that.
But keep your head up.
The hardest working man in show business was having a rough time in 1988 when legal troubles and several arrests culminated in a high-speed car chase across 3 states.
I feel good!
On September 24th, 1988, James Brown stopped by an office building he owned in Augusta, Georgia.
A class was in session in this office building when James Brown came in carrying a pistol and a shotgun and ordered everyone out.
Witnesses said Brown looked disheveled and mumbled incoherently about people using his bathrooms. He raised his guns, locked the bathrooms in question, and fled in a pickup truck.
He backed up, ran into one of the cars, ran into the other one. He backed up again, tried to run a couple of them over, and that's when they started shooting at him.
The police eventually shot out 2 of James Brown's tires, but Brown continued driving on the steel rims for more than 6 miles before crashing into a ditch. Adrian Brown claimed that her husband had simply taken too many painkillers because he was recovering from a recent surgery. The singer maintained that he was protecting his property.
What happened this weekend?
Well, I came to my office and I found somebody using my bathroom facilities without my consent.
Were you high?
High off of God.
Okay, yes. But not off of drugs?
No.
No PCP?
No, nothing but God.
No pot?
Nothing but God.
But the state's attorney saw it differently and hit Brown with 11 counts of drug, weapons, and assault charges for the incident. The Godfather of Soul pled guilty and was sentenced to 6 years in prison. He served 2 before being paroled in 1991.
So nice! With your bad self!
In 1998, George Michael went looking for love in all the wrong places. And then wham, he was busted.
If someone's waving their genitalia at you, you don't automatically assume that they're an officer of the law.
I want your sex.
When pop idol George Michael went to the Will Rogers Memorial Park in Beverly Hills, it wasn't to walk the dog. On April 7th, 1998, a man followed George into the park's bathroom.
He started playing this game. I'll show you mine, you show me yours. Once he'd got an eyeful, he walked straight past me and out, and I thought, that's kind of odd. I thought, maybe he's just not impressed, you know?
The other man turned out to be an undercover cop who arrested Michael on the spot and charged the former Wham frontman with lewd conduct. Busted in the boys' room, George Michael made headlines around the world.
To actually get caught in a public toilet, in a park, you know, when he's got a beautiful house up the road, for me, that was the kind of shocking thing.
He was fined and ordered to undergo counseling, but Michael made no apologies for his actions.
I'm not contrite for what I actually did because I wasn't being flagrant. It was completely an encounter between two adults, and it was totally private.
And he used the experience to clear up any lingering questions about his sexuality.
I'm in a relationship with a man right now. I have not been in a relationship with a woman for almost 10 years.
Then Michael parodied the incident in the video for his song, Outside.
He just totally took the situation that could have humiliated him and ruined his career and just turned it into this, like, totally funny moment, and he just moved on.
Selena Quintanilla Perez was the reigning queen of Tejano music, poised to capture the hearts of the world and cross over to mainstream stardom, until a friend's betrayal ended her dream. As a young girl, Selena traveled the South Texas back roads singing with her family. But by the time she was a teenager, she had swept the Tejano Music Awards and went on to win a Grammy.
I never thought that it would come this far. Never in my wildest dreams, I thought it would come this far. I could lose
my heart tonight. Loved and adored by millions, Selena soon became the object of obsession for one fan in particular, Yolanda Saldivar. The two quickly became friends, paving the way for Saldivar to head up Selena's fan club. But before long, Selena's family began to suspect Yolanda of theft.
I found some documents that proved that she was stealing money from the fan club. I told her, Yolanda, I'm gonna go see the police about this.
Despite the mounting evidence, Selena continued to believe in her friend until it was too late. On the morning of March 31st, 1995, 23-year-old Selena Quintanilla Perez was shot to death at a Corpus Christi motel by her friend and fan club president, Yolanda Saldivar. The tragedy drew worldwide attention, and Selena's music became more popular than ever before.
There is no doubt that she would have become a major, major phenomenon. What the tragedy did was just simply expedite the process.
She was such a young person, just full of life, and her life was cut short over a senseless, stupid thing. You know, I think about that every day, every day.
On October 23rd, 1995, Yolanda Saldivar was found guilty of first-degree murder and sentenced to life in prison.
When we come back, heavy metal goes to court.
We thought, oh, this will get thrown out because of that First Amendment issue. And then this area of subliminal messages came up.
And Rick James goes directly to jail. Next on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll.
She's a super freak, super freak, she's super freak, yeah.
In 1967, two Rolling Stones and a teenage pop star indulged in the ultimate lost weekend. And really, what band hasn't, right? There's only one problem. They got caught.
It was a bus that took two Stones to the Slammer and Marianne Faithfull to the front page. By 1967, rock's bad boys were experimenting with Eastern sitar sounds and psychedelic drugs. Marianne Faithfull was Britain's sweetheart, a 20-year-old pop singer with four top 40 hits to her name. She was also Mick Jagger's girlfriend. One February weekend, the couple gathered with friends at Keith Richards' country home and spent the day experimenting with LSD.
The door knocked. Keith answered the door and 24 cops walked in. And I had just had a bath and was wearing nothing but a fur rug.
She's got some guts, that girl. Apart from a great pair.
Police claimed they caught Faithful, Richards, and Jagger in the middle of an orgy that involved a sexual act with a candy bar.
The Mars bar, by the way, is total fiction. That was thrown in by some journalists because we were right out of Mars bars.
Mick Jagger was charged with possession of four amphetamine pills, Richards with allowing people to smoke illegal substances at his home, and Marianne Faithful wasn't charged at all.
We all were a bit shocked by British justice during the big drug bust because, you know, we really hadn't done anything.
Mick spent three nights in jail and Keith just one night before they posted bail and appealed their convictions. A month later, the sentences were overturned. The drug bust only enhanced Mick and Keith's bad boy reputations, but Marianne's career never fully recovered from the wrath of tabloid rumors. Rick James parlayed his 80s success into a life of rock star excess, but by the early 90s, his super freaky lifestyle had spiraled out of control and landed Rick a five-year prison sentence.
She's a very kinky girl.
By 1991, Rick James was spending up to $400,000 a year on cocaine. His life was a series of parties and excess.
You know, go to clubs and stuff and come home with 20, 30 people, 19 of them I never met before. And they stay for days. A lot of sex, a lot of women.
One of the women would drastically change Rick's life. In the beginning, he thought she was just another groupie.
Girl was a crack smoker. I think we had sex the first hour she was there. And the girl continued to stay at the house for weeks.
Following a lengthy drug binge, the woman alleged that Rick and his girlfriend had kept her prisoner, burned her with a crack pipe, and forced her to have sex and smoke drugs. Rick denied all the charges.
Rick James had never had to make no girl have sex in his life. I mean, and he's never had to torture. I mean, I'm just not, that's not me. That's not me.
Rick James was arrested and tried on more than 15 felony counts. He was found guilty of assault, false imprisonment, and sale of a controlled substance, and served over 2 years of a five-year prison sentence.
I was in Folsom Prison. I was in hell, the belly of the beast. I don't ever want to go back. And I got to be conscious 24/7 that there's eyes all around me watching Rick James.
Released in 1996, Rick says prison helped him quit drugs and get his life in order. In 1985, two Nevada boys formed a deadly suicide pact while listening to heavy metal music. 5 years later, the music went on trial. After a day of smoking pot, drinking, and listening to Judas Priest, Raymond Belknap and James Vance tried to kill themselves with a shotgun.
Raymond Belknap took this shotgun, placed it under his chin, and pulled the trigger, ending his young life of 18 years.
Raymond Belknap was killed instantly. James Vance shot himself in the head but survived. Later, he explained their motives in a letter to Raymond's mother, causing her to bring a wrongful death lawsuit against the band she felt responsible for her son's death.
Since I believe that alcohol and heavy metal music, such as Judas Priest, led us or even mesmerized us into believing the answer to life was death.
We thought, oh, this will get thrown out because of that First Amendment issue. And then this area of subliminal messages came up.
The prosecution charged that the teenagers tried to kill themselves because subliminal messages in a Judas Priest song told them to do it.
I had been working with an expert on subliminals. He found specific subliminal words embedded in this song, Better By You, Better Than Me.
It's better by you, better than me.
They actually were able to convince the judge that by listening and listening and listening and listening, you would hear this phrase, do it. Well, do what?
Are there subliminal do it on the Better By You, Better Than Me song?
Absolutely not.
After 2 weeks of intense testimony, Judas Priest was exonerated.
There was the phrase, do it, subliminally on the record, but it was caused by a chance occurrence of two sounds coming together to form those words.
It was an incredibly important moment. If God forbid, we'd have been found guilty, it would have been a firestorm throughout the world of media. Breaking the law, breaking the law.
When we come back, Prince gets a new title.
Just sort of pushed him over that line from, like, excessively weird to weird weird.
And we say goodbye to the king on VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. From Madonna to Cher to Sting, pop stars have often gone by single names, but one reclusive artist did just the opposite. He gave up his memorable royal moniker and showed the world the power of a symbol.
It's the story of the prince who turned into a... He was born Prince Rogers Nelson and became one of rock's most prolific and reclusive artists. But he shocked the world when he legally changed his name to an unpronounceable symbol.
I mean, what are you supposed to call him?
You don't pronounce it. It is not to be spoken.
So journalists referred to him as the artist formerly known as Prince. He gave no explanation for the change, but many speculated it had to do with an ongoing battle with his record company, Warner Brothers.
They were in this stalemate about artistic freedom, so his thing was, well, I'm gonna change my name.
While he wouldn't talk about his legal battle, he began appearing with the word slave written on his face, leaving little doubt about his relationship with the record company.
I think it just sort of pushed him over that line from, like, excessively weird to weird weird.
Things got even weirder in 1995 when the artist did an interview with the BBC in a mask and broke his silence on the name change, sort of.
He changed his name because his spirit told him to.
Apparently, his spirit spoke to him again on May 16th, 2000, after his contract with Warner Brothers had finally expired.
I will now go back to using my name instead of the symbol I adopted as a means to free myself from all undesirable relationships.
We were all a little worried, but now he's Prince again, so we can feel good.
My name is Prince.
Charles Manson was behind some of the most horrific murders of the 1960s. Murders, some speculate, were brought on by an unlikely friendship with the kings of surf pop. By 1968, the Beach Boys were giving off less than good vibrations. Fame, money, and drug use had taken a toll on the seemingly wholesome quintet. In April, Beach Boys drummer Dennis Wilson befriended a small, wiry drifter and aspiring musician named Charles Manson.
Music was a very big part of his life. He also was a murderer, of course, but he may not have been a murderer if he had been accepted into the rock music industry.
Manson and his followers moved in with Wilson. He gave them food, clothes, use of his cars, and money. Wilson also introduced him to Beach Boys producer Terry Melcher, who allegedly promised Manson a record deal. In September, the Beach Boys recorded a song of Manson's they retitled Never Learn Not to Love, but Manson wasn't happy with the results.
They changed a lot of the lyrics around, which really, really upset Charlie.
Soon after, Wilson and Melcher noticed a frightening change in Manson. There were rumors he had killed a local drug dealer. And when Manson left a bullet with a warning on Wilson's doorstep, Wilson and Melcher tried to sever their ties with the would-be musician.
That's one of the reasons why Dennis Wilson cleared out of his own house. I think he was afraid of Charles.
The Manson family were then charged with a series of violent murders at the former home of Beach Boys producer Terry Melcher. And according to Manson family member Susan Atkins, Manson had picked the house to instill fear in Melcher for breaking his word about the record contract. He was the undisputed king of rock and roll, but by the mid-70s, Elvis Presley seemed intent on destroying himself. By 1977, Elvis Presley had transformed from a hip-swiveling chart-topper into a middle-aged Las Vegas performer.
He looked tired and puffy and just lackluster. It was very hurtful to watch how he went downhill. He just plummeted.
On August 15, 1977, Elvis was nervous about his upcoming tour and depressed over a new tell-all book that accused him of excessive drug use. At 4:30 a.m. on the morning of the 16th, Elvis, unable to sleep, rehearsed new songs and played racquetball. Around 5:30, he said goodnight to his girlfriend, Ginger Alden, and went into his bathroom. It was the last time anyone would see Elvis alive.
Elvis Presley died today. He was 42. Apparently, it was a heart attack. He was found at his home in Memphis, not breathing. His doctor pronounced him dead at 3 o'clock this afternoon.
9-year-old Lisa Marie Presley called Linda Thompson and broke the news.
She just burst into tears and said, "My daddy's dead." So I just tried to comfort her as much as I could. But it was a horrible day.
Elvis's death shook the world. Thousands of heartbroken fans flocked to Graceland to pay their final respects to the king.
Those white limousines driving along Elvis Presley Boulevard, and how people are lined up all along the length of the highway just to pay homage to him. And it was very moving, very touching, and very appropriate.
Although the medical examiner's report listed the official cause of death as heart failure, an autopsy later revealed Elvis had a potentially lethal mix of painkillers, sedatives, and muscle relaxants in his system when he died. Whatever the cause of Elvis's death, his influence on rock and roll remains undiminished.
He was one of the most electrifying entertainers I ever heard, black or white. I think he left much too early to me.
Well, that's all for this hour, but believe it or not, things are going to get even more shocking. There are still 20 shocking moments to go, and in the next hour, we will count down to number one. I'm Mark McGrath. I'll see you then. This is it, the final hour of VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll. I'm Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray. What's shocking is often subjective. What shocks you might not even raise an eyebrow for someone else. But tonight, we are sure to have something to shock everyone. VH1 has come up with the ultimate list of rock's most shocking moments. And in this hour, we're counting down to number one. We begin with a simple home video. Great way to remember a holiday. But the triple X shock of this video proved it might be best to keep these memories in the family.
It was the most popular home video of the year. But it was never meant to be seen by anyone. In 1994, Motley Crue drummer Tommy Lee and his wife, actress Pamela Anderson, made a very intimate home video of their honeymoon.
I love you.
I love you.
I love you so much.
We're doing things that every married couple probably does. Those are tapes of us on vacation and stuff. It wasn't like we filmed some porno.
But somehow, the Internet Entertainment Group got their hands on the illicit tape and posted it on their website. Bootleg copies circulated at a massive rate. It was rumored that the couple had released the video themselves for publicity, but Tommy and Pamela claimed the tape had been stolen from their home.
Somebody just went and exploited the hell out of our life.
Spread your legs for me, please.
The Lees sued IEG and eventually settled out of court, but the tape was soon available everywhere. $77 million made. The Lees continued to deny they made any money from the tape, but did make a music video satirizing the event. Before Michael Jackson was known as the king of pop, he sold pop with Pepsi, and the results were explosive. Shortly after Thriller went platinum, Michael Jackson struck a deal with Pepsi Cola. To promote the reunion tour, Michael and his brothers would appear in a commercial, reworking the lyrics to Billie Jean. The commercial was to premiere during the Grammy Awards on February 28, 1984. The shoot took place on January 27th in Los Angeles. Everything was going as planned until a mistimed firework sprayed Jackson with sparks, setting his hair aflame.
I saw him dance down the stairs. I could not tell that his hair caught fire. And it wasn't until I saw everybody rush him that I knew something was wrong. Only because he's so incredibly talented, he did two quick spins. And the fire seemed to go out, by his own force.
Michael was rushed to the hospital and treated for second-degree burns. The accident created so much interest in the Pepsi commercial, MTV premiered it in an hour-long special before the Grammys for free. Thriller went on to win 8 Grammys, which Jackson accepted, wearing a hairpiece. In the early 80s, Ozzy Osbourne was the target of everyone, from the religious right to the ASPCA. But one afternoon, while having lunch with the staff of his new record label, he bit off a little more than he could chew. In 1980, the former Black Sabbath frontman inked a solo deal with Epic Records. The label initially had only lukewarm interest in the heavy metal star.
We had to go into Epic to meet everyone. So we said, all right, let's take some Doves. And we'll release the Doves and everybody will say, oh, how nice, how sweet, and how lovely.
Sharon says to me, I want you to go in there and make an impression and throw these Doves in the air. I says, yeah, I'll make an impression.
With birds in his pocket and booze in his bloodstream, a visibly drunk Ozzy stepped into a crowded luncheon at Epic Records and released some of the Doves.
He sits on this girl's knee, who's head of publicity. She really didn't want him there. And the bird landed on Ozzy's knee.
And then he took a bite.
And there's all these smiling people going. And this carcass was flapping around the table and feathers were flying in the air and they were all like throwing up all over the place. And people were just freaked.
With blood still dripping from his lip, Ozzy was escorted out of the building and told never to return.
And on the way out, he had another one in his pocket and he did it again and threw it in reception.
Epic released the record despite the incident. Blizzard of Oz went gold within weeks and launched Ozzy's successful solo career.
Up next, Led Zeppelin redefines Shark Attack. And Elvis hits below the belt when VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll continues. In the next shocking moment, one hard-rocking band found a whole new way to enjoy seafood with the help of a very dedicated groupie.
It's one of rock's most famous urban legends. But what really happened with Led Zeppelin, the groupie, and the mud shark? During Led Zeppelin's 1969 tour with Vanilla Fudge, drummer John Bonham and road manager Richard Cole caught an eyeful one afternoon in a Seattle hotel.
Bonzo and I were fishing out the window of the hotel. We heard noise from another room, and of course we didn't want to miss out on anything. And we went over there, and there was some girl lying on the floor.
And the chick was like, up for anything. The chick was sitting on a chair, and they were like hitting her on the back with the mud shark. This chick had everything done to her, with the fish, with ketchup, with bottles, with butter, with everything. She liked it.
Accounts of the incident vary, and at least one member of Led Zeppelin questions whether any of them are true.
I don't know whether it really happened. I mean, I don't recall that incident.
But the participants claim the whole thing was documented.
Mark Stein shot it on camera.
Mark Stein, our keyboard player, took it, and it was lost. We don't know whatever happened to that 8mm.
Put that on eBay, I'm sure it would go up to a rocket in price.
Sex Pistols bassist Sid Vicious was the sneering face of punk rock until one morning when he woke up and found himself charged with murder. I am an Antichrist. On October 11th, 1978, Sid Vicious and his girlfriend Nancy Spungen were indulging in an all-night drug binge at the Chelsea Hotel in New York City.
There was a party that night, and Sid had taken about 32-anols, which is a very strong sedative, and he was passed out on the bed.
According to Sid, he woke up the next morning and found Nancy dead in a pool of blood in the bathroom.
Sid genuinely did not know if he had killed Nancy or not, you know? He really didn't remember.
There were no witnesses, and $80 was missing from the room. Theories abounded as to what actually transpired that night at the Chelsea Hotel.
There's theories that, you know, he was in a blackout, he got up and he stabbed Nancy. There was a theory that there was a suicide pact. There was a theory that she got into a fight with a drug dealer, and the drug dealer stabbed her and took the money and split.
He stabbed her. She had a bad mouth and a big nagging woman and controlled him mercilessly.
Whatever the truth, Sid was charged with murder and sent to the detox unit of Rikers Island Prison. After 4 days, he was released on bail. On February 2nd, 1979, while awaiting trial, Sid died of a heroin overdose. Nancy Spungen's murder was never solved.
Parents have had a long-standing battle with rock and roll. Thank God they'd never managed to keep the volume down for too long. But in 1989, four crusading moms reached for the mute button.
In September 1985, the Parents Music Resource Center was demanding warning labels on recordings deemed explicit, but rock and roll fought back. We're not gonna
take it. This began with four mothers who were very concerned over the music that their young children were listening to.
They were the PMRC, headed by Washington wives Tipper Gore and Susan Baker, and they took their case to the Senate.
They weren't just going to put a sticker on a record. This was going to be used as a way of eliminating certain records from being carried in the stores.
Who has the authority to decide what is too much? Who gets to make the decision as to what the rating is?
You know, and while Tipper and Susan are whispering in their husband's ears, they've got their hand discreetly put someplace else and saying, honey, I want a Senate hearing.
When the hearings convened, an unlikely trio made a case for protection of musicians' First Amendment rights.
The establishment of a rating system, voluntary or otherwise, opens the door to an endless parade of moral quality control programs based on things certain Christians don't like.
The most effective people were the artists, and of the artists, the most effective one was John Denver.
May I be very clear that I'm strongly opposed to censorship of any kind in our society or anywhere else in the world.
You know, he was a very good spokesperson for the free speech side because he didn't fit the stereotype of a rebel.
Despite the artist's testimony, the record industry finally agreed to put warning labels on recordings deemed explicit.
Recordings that are so identified will state explicit lyrics, parental advisory.
Today, the debate over lyrical content continues. Albums are still labeled with warnings, and many radio stations and large retail chains still refuse to carry stickered albums. In the 1950s, American television was straight-laced and buttoned down, until one man's gyrations got everyone all shook up. I'm all shook up. On June 5th, 1956, Elvis Presley appeared on The Milton Berle Show. His unrestrained, sexually charged performance captivated and scandalized a nationwide audience. You ain't nothing but a hound
dog. Elvis was sexual, period. And that scared people, it offended people. People thought it had to be stamped out lest vulgarity overtake the country. You ain't another quarter rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine.
Elvis the Pelvis was too risque for many parents, but for their kids, he was an irresistible force.
Elvis Presley was driving the white kids crazy with this nigger music. That's what the system was saying.
Elvis's performance sparked a national outrage. NBC was flooded with calls and letters protesting the vulgarity. But the humble boy from Tennessee didn't see what all the fuss was about.
It's only singing and dancing. I don't see how they could think that it would contribute to juvenile delinquency. If there's anything I've tried to do, I've tried to live a straight, clean life and not set any kind of a bad example.
In the wake of the national uproar, Elvis's popularity skyrocketed. 3 months after the controversial performance, Ed Sullivan, who vowed never to have Elvis on his show, relented and booked the swivel-hipped singer. There was a compromise. Elvis would be shown only from the waist up, but Sullivan's attempt to tame Presley failed. The show attracted a record 60 million viewers. I'm all
shook up. When we come back, kissing cousins make headlines, and Madonna proves that sex sells. when the 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll continues. Erotic. It's not uncommon for middle-aged rock stars to date girls nearly half their age. But when a rocker in his mid-20s tried to do the same, it almost cost him his career.
He was supposed to be the next Elvis Presley, but less than a year after he was dubbed the new king of rock and roll, Jerry Lee Lewis's career was destroyed by scandal. Jerry Lee was only 21 years old when he exploded on the national scene. But at the height of his career, Jerry fell in love with the 13-year-old daughter of his cousin and bass player, Jay Brown, and asked her to marry him.
I said, "Jerry, are you crazy? I'm only 13 years old." And he said, "Myra, it's now or never." And I said, "Okay, then I guess it'll be now."
Jerry Lee and Myra were secretly wed on December 11th, 1957.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain.
By May of 1958, Jerry Lee was riding high with two hit singles and took his band to England for a 37-day tour. Despite his manager's pleas, Jerry also brought his young bride.
When we got off the plane, the press was there, and they would come over and say, "And pardon me, miss, who are you?" And I said, I'm Jerry's wife. And he went, "Wife?"
For 5 days, Jerry and his child bride were front page news as the scandal exploded. Performances were canceled, and the British press demanded Jerry Lee's exile.
We thought, "Oh God, please let us just get back home where they love us and they'll treat us right."
But it was too late. The news had spread to the States.
"Well, the papers reported that you were greeted with silence over there and with catcalls from the audience. Is that right?"
"Well, I can't agree with them there, sir. Our audience was very nice and very good."
"Did you notice anything like that sort of reception?"
"No, it was a very good reception, I thought."
All of a sudden, these Americans were ashamed of us. It was a scandal that nobody wanted to touch.
Though Jerry Lee continued to record and perform, his career would never recover.
Had I answered that one question differently, when they said, "And who are you, miss?" I could have said, "I'm Jay Brown's daughter." And it would have changed history.
In 1969, the Alice Cooper Band was just another struggling rock group. But all that changed one night in Toronto with a chicken. On September 13th, Alice Cooper was opening for The Doors and John Lennon at a Toronto rock festival. Someone in the audience responded to the band's performance with a little more than applause.
In the middle of all this, here comes this white chicken flying up. Now, first of all, who brought a chicken to the concert?
Alice did what came naturally. He threw the chicken back.
"You know, I'm from Detroit. I've never been on a farm. It had feathers, it had wings, it's gonna fly." It didn't fly as much as it plummeted into the audience, and they tore it to pieces. And then threw the parts back up. Next thing I know, Frank Zappa's calling me and saying, "Did you kill a chicken on stage?" "No, I'd never do that." "Well, don't tell anybody, it's the greatest story."
Alice's audience loved it, and by the 1971 Killer Tour, Alice Cooper was playing to sold-out arenas. The stage show had escalated into stunning theatrics and elaborate props. But everyone still seems to remember the chicken incident.
To this day, no matter where I go, the ASPCA is there going, "No killing chickens on stage." "Okay, I promise I won't." "Okay. Go tell that to Colonel Sanders. He kills 7 million chickens a day." You know, if I would have barbecued the chicken right then, it probably would have been okay.
She bared it. We bought it. When Madonna's erotic coffee table book Sex hit the stores in 1992, there were lines, leashes, and plenty of hype.
It's a book of erotic fantasies as told by Dita Paolo, a character, and she kind of takes on different personas and different characters, and that's it.
The book came sealed in Mylar with a disclaimer. For $49.95, buyers got Madonna unwrapped.
The sex book was sort of like the pinnacle of me challenging people and saying, "I'm going to be sexually provocative. and I'm going to be ironic, and I'm going to prove that I can get everybody's attention and that everyone's going to be interested in it and still be freaked out about it.
And they were. Critics assailed Madonna for overexposure, and even some of Madonna's friends just didn't get it.
She was showing me pictures of it, and I was like, why are you doing this?
But many people saw the book as pushing the boundaries of sexual freedom.
She already challenged all these social taboos about sex, and this was kind of like the last gate to kick open.
Women aren't allowed to be sexual and erotic and provocative and intelligent and thoughtful at the same time.
Regardless of what people thought, they bought Sex. Over 500,000 copies of it.
As a lyricist, John Lennon was known for his way with words. But his words got him in trouble in 1966 when he made one notorious statement.
I just said what I said and it was wrong, or was taken wrong, and now it's all this.
By 1966, the Beatles were the biggest band in the world. But even some of their most devoted fans were outraged when John Lennon said the Beatles were more popular than Jesus. Lennon made the statement in a London newspaper forecasting the decline of Christianity. The comments were ignored in England, but when reprinted out of context in an American teen magazine, two DJs jumped on it.
And I said, that does it for me. We're not going to play his records anymore. It was just an offhand comment that we made for a joke.
But the joke turned serious when the Associated Press ran their comments on the wire.
As each day went by, more and more stations were going along with banning the Beatles. And so then Tommy and I started really getting into it.
Our fantastic Beatle boycott is still in effect. Don't you forget what the Beatles have said. Don't forget to take your Beatle records and your Beatle paraphernalia to any one of our 14 pickup points.
By midsummer, the Beatle backlash was burning out of control. It was now up to Lennon to put out the fire.
I wasn't knocking it or putting it down, I was just saying it as a fact. You know, I'm not saying that we're better or greater or comparing us with Jesus Christ as a person or God as a thing or whatever it is.
There was never a rock star who'd been put in that position where their words mattered that much.
Lennon's explanation calmed the hysteria. Even the Vatican accepted his apology. But for the Beatles, it marked the end of their innocence. She was one of the most provocative performers of the 90s, but one night on live television, her politics took center stage. On October 3rd, 1992, Sinead O'Connor was the musical guest on Saturday Night Live. Everything ran smoothly until the end of her performance when she produced a picture of Pope John Paul II, tore it into pieces, and said, "Fight the real enemy."
When she tore up the picture of the Pope, I think everybody wasn't quite sure what had happened. It was just complete silence.
For those who weren't clear about what had happened, Sinead clarified matters soon after on CNN.
The church must be brought down. They must be destroyed. Their control over the human race must be revealed.
Catholics around the world were stunned, angry, and organized. Viewers flooded Saturday Night Live with complaints, and the National Ethnic Coalition steamrolled over hundreds of her CDs. 2 weeks later, Sinead performed at a Bob Dylan tribute concert and was booed off the stage.
Don't let the bastards get you down.
It's been so lonely without you.
Though her career never fully recovered, Sinead remained publicly defiant.
To me, the ripping of the picture was an artistic statement. People call it crazy. But from my point of view, I think it was a genius thing to do.
Years after the 1969 Woodstock Festival, fans flocked to Rome, New York to celebrate another 3 days of peace, love, and music. But it would be no 60s love fest.
Go!
The concert took place on a closed Air Force base that had once been a toxic waste site.
Yeah!
The first day proceeded with little incident. By the second day, temperature soared and fans began to feel the heat. Despite the high cost of tickets, promoters failed to provide concertgoers with enough working bathrooms, water, trash cans, or security.
It was a big gig for money. They hired a bunch of bands to play. They charged people as much as they possibly could.
I spent $400 that weekend just inside the gates. You know, never mind the $170 I spent on a ticket. My name is King!
As the day wore on and the music blared, the pressure grew.
You can only deal with so much before you just say, that's it, I've had it. People do go crazy, people do snap.
By the final night, as the Red Hot Chili Peppers took the stage for the last performance, the exhausted crowd had had enough. With candles distributed by the concert organizers, audience members started bonfires. They knocked down scaffolding, destroyed concession stands, and stole from vendors.
I attempted to take a few things. I'm not going to lie to you.
By the time it was over, there was more than $500,000 in damages. 44 people had been arrested. One out of 20 were treated for injuries. And 8 cases of rape and sexual assault were reported.
Lip-syncing was never a crime until this pop duo came along. And it cost them everything.
They had all the ingredients for pop mega stardom, except one. They couldn't sing. Girl, you know it's true. For 2 years, Rob Pilatus and Fabrice Morvan topped the charts as Milli Vanilli. But the pop duo's hits were actually sung by a musically accomplished but middle-aged band formed by producer Frank Farian. Farian needed sex appeal to sell his record, so he approached Rob and Fab.
He needed an act who poses as a singer. You know, he don't want us to sing. Baby, don't be
shy when you're holding my hand. Willing to go along with the charade, the duo scored 3 number one hits and won the 1989 Grammy for Best New Artist. But in July of 1989, the illusion began to unravel. While performing live on MTV, their pre-recorded tapes skipped during their performance.
Stop. Girl, you know it's girl, you know it's girl. 80,000 people. Girl, you know it's girl, you know. You know, I couldn't repeat it 15 times.
Ridiculed by the press, Frank Farian decided to expose their secret.
Your producer told you lip-synced, and that was the end.
Milli Vanilli became the first artist in history to have their Grammy revoked.
So we give this Grammy back now? We thought we still had opportunities.
Rob and Fab recorded an album featuring their own voices. It never made the charts.
We didn't know that that was the end for Milli Vanilli.
On April 2nd, 1998, Rob committed suicide. It was billed as the biggest concert to hit Cincinnati in years. But what happened on December 3rd, 1979, has gone down as one of the most tragic events in rock history. By 7 p.m., thousands of fans with festival seating tickets had arrived to see the sold-out show.
Festival seating is general admission, first come, first serve. Everybody wanted to get in to get the best spot they could get.
But the doors to the Coliseum remained closed.
They couldn't open the doors until the Who group could take the stage and do their sound checks.
A lot of people thought that the concert had already started, so by then, people, I think, started to push forward to get in through the door.
You were just literally being smashed into the people in front of you, and you know, you almost had to stand on your toes just to get air.
At 7:30, approximately 4 of the doors were opened, and thousands of eager fans tried to force their way through.
I remember screaming for people to stop pushing, and you know, because it hurt, you know, it hurt a lot.
Caught in the frenzy, Diana Kubert was tripped and fell to the ground.
I remember when I was laying there, I mean, they were walking on me.
The stampede continued for over 20 minutes.
There were bodies laying everywhere, some that were dead, many that were injured.
Diana was one of the lucky ones. She was spotted and pulled to safety.
I was thankful, you know, that I was breathing, that I was alive.
The concert went on with The Who and most of the audience completely unaware of the tragedy outside.
We didn't find out until after the show. And Bill Kirbyshley, who was our manager, his face was like slate. And he said, if you're going to do an encore, please make it brief, because something very, very serious has happened.
11 fans had died of asphyxiation.
We just feel helpless at the moment.
There just doesn't seem to be anything we can do about last night. I just hope to hell it doesn't ever happen again.
There's no question in my mind that festival seating was the root cause of the Who concert tragedy.
3 weeks later, festival seating was banned in Cincinnati.
Totally shocked when Marvin Gaye actually got killed. Whoa.
I mean, it was like somebody was playing a sad joke on all of us.
Marvin Gaye helped put Motown on the map with a string of early hits before branching out on his own with a more politically conscious voice. But he endured a life caught between the spiritual and the self-destructive.
Sometimes the pain that causes you to be a musical genius could also cause you to be your own worst enemy.
By 1983, he was battling a severe addiction to cocaine. He moved into his parents' home to regroup, but his instability brought him into violent conflicts with his father, Marvin Gaye Sr., who was a minister and objected to Marvin's lifestyle.
It must be a painful thing to be known all over the world but not have the recognition you want from your own father.
On the morning of April 1st, 1984, just one day before Marvin Gaye's 45th birthday, he and his father began arguing violently. Claiming self-defense, Marvin Gaye Sr. shot his son twice. At the hospital, Marvin Gaye was pronounced dead on arrival.
Singer Marvin Gaye's father is in jail in Los Angeles this morning, held without bail and facing murder charges in the death of his son.
Following a short trial, Marvin Gaye Sr. was sentenced to 5 years probation. He died of pneumonia in 1998.
A lot of our history and our culture is in the music, so the Marvin Gaye thing was jarring because you felt like you almost lost a family member. Whoa, oh, mercy,
mercy me. Next, the shocking moments keep coming as we hit the final four. VH1's 100 Most Shocking Moments in Rock and Roll continues after this. By the early 1990s, Kurt Cobain had established himself as the musical voice of a new generation. He was brilliant, he was anguished, and before he turned 30, he was dead.
The body of the lead singer of Nirvana
Cobain was
discovered
killed by a shotgun blast to the head.
A shotgun blast to the head.
Kurt Cobain, the leader of Nirvana,
now at the
is
age
dead.
Of 27, Kurt Cobain is dead.
In 1991, Nirvana exploded onto the scene and changed the face of popular music. But lead singer Kurt Cobain had difficulty adjusting to his newfound fame and wealth.
His whole point was, I don't want to be a rock star like those other rock stars are rock stars. And the machine was too big. You couldn't then not be on MTV. You couldn't not be winning awards and having paparazzi follow you and everything that, you know, that he hated and everything that he had gotten into it to act against.
In March of 1994, battling heroin addiction and depression, Cobain attempted suicide in a Rome hotel room. He survived and later sought help at a Marina Del Rey rehab center, but fled after only 2 days and disappeared into the Seattle drug underworld. 6 days later, on April 5th, 1994, using a shotgun he had purchased only 1 week earlier, Kurt Cobain committed suicide at the Seattle home he shared with wife Courtney Love and daughter Frances Bean. He was 27 years old.
Kurt Cobain, the leader of one of rock's most gifted and promising bands, Nirvana, is dead. Police found what is said to be a suicide note at the scene, but have not yet divulged its contents.
When you have a fundamental feeling about the world, and that's all jerked out from you, it's traumatic. Kurt never really made it through that, you know?
On April 10th, thousands of grief-stricken fans gathered at a Seattle vigil. In a taped message, Courtney Love read parts of Cobain's suicide note.
The worst crime I could think of would be to pull people off by faking it, pretending as if I'm having 100% fun. No, Kurt, the worst crime I could think of is for you to just continue being a rock star when you hate it and just stop.
As she continued, Courtney was overwhelmed by her grief.
really sorry, you guys. I don't know what I could have done. I was at a barrier. What else should I be?
All apologies. Cobain's death was a startling reminder of the pressures of stardom, and the vigil illustrated how deeply Cobain's suicide had affected his fans' lives.
To kids who were drawn to him through their own hopelessness and their own frustration, you know, it was only further confirmation that, you know, yeah, it is that messed up.
It was supposed to be Woodstock West, but instead of peace, love, and music, the day's mix of Hell's Angels and poor planning ended in tragedy, and some say, the death of the 60s. In late November 1969, the Rolling Stones announced that they were planning a free concert in San Francisco.
The location is not Golden Gate Park, unfortunately, but somewhere adjacent to it, which is a bit larger.
Last-minute venue changes meant that organizers had little more than 24 hours to pull it all together, and they made some surprising choices, like asking the Hell's Angels to provide concert security.
We did the security, and they asked us to do it, and I did exactly what I said I would do, and I like keeping my word.
The Hell's Angels were a violent gang. They were dangerous people, and if you were smart, you stayed away from them.
The day of the concert dawned cold, gray, and gloomy, and there was something else in the air.
The feeling in the crowd, the mood was unpleasant and mean right from the beginning.
People were exhausted, other people were just out of their minds, so the Stones came on into that atmosphere.
The Rolling Stones took the stage, aware of ongoing skirmishes between the Angels and the crowd. Mick Taylor had joined the band just 6 months before Altamont.
We plugged in and we played and it seemed to be okay, and then things went wrong.
Every time they would start to get ready to play and start to go into a song, there would violence would interrupt around the stage, and then they would stop.
We all felt the same. God, what are we gonna do? How are we gonna get out of this one alive?
It was like being caught in a play that has to have a finale. Somebody had to die.
Before the Stones finished their set, the body of 18-year-old Meredith Hunter was airlifted from the site. He'd been stabbed 5 times and beaten to death by the Hell's Angels.
No good deed goes unpunished. The deed that we were punished for was having the free concert, and the punishment was the end of the Flower Generation.
Only 2 moments remain. What is the most shocking moment in rock history? The answer when we return. He had been a child star, a cartoon character, and a hero to his fans. The idea that he was guilty of child abuse seemed unthinkable. But in 1993, Michael Jackson had to face the music and the world.
It was the most humiliating ordeal of my life.
In August 1993, the scandal broke.
The Los Angeles Police Department initiated a criminal investigation of entertainer Michael Jackson.
A 13-year-old boy and frequent companion of Michael Jackson had accused the pop star of sexual abuse.
You didn't want to believe it, but then it was like, well, he's kind of a weird guy, so do we really know what's going on there?
Investigators raided his Neverland Ranch, an L.A. condo. They turned up no physical evidence, but media scrutiny intensified. The boy filed a civil suit against Jackson. Michael maintained his innocence, claiming the accusation was a result of a failed extortion attempt. But the damage was done. Michael Jackson canceled his Dangerous tour, citing an addiction to painkillers. The tabloids searched out anyone who would talk. Ex-employees of Jackson's went on record about slumber parties at Neverland Ranch. But the most damaging statement came from Jackson's own sister, LaToya.
These kids are going to be scarred for the rest of their life, and I don't want to see any more innocent small children being affected this way.
The rest of the Jackson clan stood behind Michael. On December 22nd, he made a live statement refuting the charges.
They served a search warrant on me, which allowed them to view and photograph my body, including my penis, my buttocks, my lower torso, thighs, and any other area that they wanted. But if this is what I have to endure to prove my innocence, my complete innocence, so be it.
Before it could come to trial, Jackson settled out of court with the boy's family for an undisclosed sum.
The resolution of this case is in no way an admission of guilt by Michael Jackson.
In September 1994, after more than a year of investigation, prosecutors said they would not file criminal charges against Jackson.
He was an activist, a poet, a risk taker, and one of the leaders of rock's most famous band. But on December 8, 1980, the world lost John Lennon forever.
This is WNEW-FM in New York. I have the extremely sad task of informing you that John Lennon died tonight. And I am at a loss for words. I think for the first time in my career on the radio, I don't have anything to say.
On December 8, 1980, after 5 years out of the limelight, John Lennon was enjoying the success of his new album, Double Fantasy.
Our life together.
That afternoon, he gave what would be his final interview to RKO Radio and shared his hopes for the future.
When I was singing and writing this, I was visualizing all the people of my age group. I'm singing to them. I'm saying, how are you? Wasn't the 70s a drag, you know? Here we are, well, let's try and make the 80s good, you know? While there's life, there's hope.
After the interview, John and Yoko went to their recording studio and celebrated the fact that Double Fantasy had been certified as a gold record.
On a spiritual level, he was so high, and some force kind of wanted to stop it, I suppose.
Shortly before 11 p.m., John and Yoko returned to their apartment at the Dakota, where a deranged fan named Mark David Chapman fired 5 shots from a handgun, hitting John Lennon 4 times.
I was in a minicab in London, and suddenly it came on the radio and they announced that John Lennon had been shot in New York. And then I got to John Dunbar's flat in Maida Vale, white and shaking, to find John white and shaking. And we were all white and shaking.
Imagine there's no heaven.
Almost immediately, thousands of fans began gathering outside the Dakota as the world reacted with disbelief, shock, and outrage.
Lennon was a great visionary. He was somebody who had all of this symbolic power. He was an international symbol of peace. He was somebody who seemed bigger than rock and roll, bigger than music. He just seemed to encompass it all. And when he died, all of that seemed to be lost.
Imagine all the people.
6 days later, millions of people around the world stood silent for 10 minutes to honor John Lennon's unique spirit, as Yoko Ono had requested. Fans still gather on December 8th each year to honor the memory and the music of John Lennon.
Obviously, this wasn't just somebody who was a popular singer. This was somebody who meant a lot more than that. And there's no way to make sense out of something like that.
And the world will live as one.
Well, there you have it. The 100 most shocking moments in rock and roll. To all you rock stars whose wildness, daring, and willingness to take risks make rock and roll such an unpredictable art form, we thank you. And to those who simply shocked us, we salute you too. I'm Mark McGrath. Thanks a lot for watching. Yeah.